Welcome back to the Amp Energy 500 at the world's fastest stock car facility, Talladega Super Speedway. This broadcast is available in Spanish by activating your SAP button presented by ESPN Deportes. It usually doesn't take long for action to heat up at Talladega. This weekend was no exception. Back on Friday morning, Dale Earnhardt Jr. had engine woes, which forced him to go to a backup engine. Then in the final practice session on Friday afternoon, he cuts a right rear tire and triggers a multi-car crash, which forces him and four others to go to backup cars. Today, Dale Earnhardt Jr. starts his backup car with his backup engine at the back of the field. Let's visit with him. He's our in-race reporter.
Dale Jr., Dale Jarrett with ESPN. You have a copy?
Yes, sir.
Jr., can you give our viewers an idea of just how mentally taxing this 500 miles today is on a driver?
Well, it depends. I mean, if you get up there and you can lead a lot of laps, that's really the place to be for the easiest job mentally. But if you're in the pack, three wide, two wide, you know, 10th, 5th car in line in these packs, man, it can wear you out. It's the guy who can still make sharp, sound decisions at the end of the race mentally, who's going to be the guy that can improve his position and put himself in position to win.
All right, Junior, our next question comes from our ESPN mailbag, and James in Woburn, Maine would like to know, because you have to start from the back of the pack, what will your strategy be to move to the front?
Well, this is what I look for. Probably the first 15 cars and see how they're racing. If they're getting three wide up there, then there's no point in even running up in behind that because I can't go anywhere once I get there. So what I try to do is, normally at the first of the race, by lap 10 or so, it's going to be pretty hairy. Guys are going to be three or four wide. So there's really no reason to get in the middle of that. So I'll wait for them to settle down, get back to two by two racing, and which they normally do the last half of the fuel run. Everybody kind of calms down a little bit. Try to pick my way up through there at that point.
All right, Junior, thanks for talking with us today. Have a great day. And now Andy's going to speak with your crew chief, Tony Urie Jr.
Hey,
Paul.
Hey, Tony Jr., Andy Petrie, you got us?
Sure.
Hey, Tony, you know, everybody talks about how the drivers are apprehensive here, and we kind of understand that, but why don't you share with us how hard it is to sit on top of that pit box and watch this thing all day long?
It's probably one of the few races, Andy, that we can just enjoy the race. I mean, Dale Jr. does an awesome job here running, but basically there ain't a whole lot the team can do. We have to do all of our work back at the shop, and the guys have done a great job preparing these cars, but we're locked into so much, we just come down here and basically make sure we keep our fuel strategy straight and make sure we keep good tires on it all day.
Do you have any concerns about the engine in the car after losing that one on Friday?
No, we just think that was a freak deal. The guys have been checking over all the engines this week, and nearly that was just kind of an oddball deal. So we're really not worried about that. This is our 500 car, so we're really looking forward to getting this race going.
Okay, Tony, thanks for talking to us, and good luck today.
Thank you, man.
We will take you inside these wild two and three wide drafts throughout the afternoon with onboard cameras in nine different cars, seven of which are chase contenders, including two of the top drivers in points, Jimmy Johnson and Carl Edwards. When we return, we'll take a look at the starting grid and explain why Jimmy Johnson should be worried about October's in Talladega after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
He's the biggest threat just because he's so well versed.
Jimmy Johnson takes the win.
Jimmy Johnson has the most momentum right now.
I know that when the 48 gets on a roll, they lay a lot of them down in a row and they're hard to beat.
They always peak late, right at the right time.
If you're going to win the championship in 2008, you're going to have to beat that guy in the 48.
He's won the last two championships. He knows how to do this.
Doesn't matter what you did at the beginning of the year. It's what you're doing right now, and he's making it happen right now.
Jimmy Johnson is certainly a threat to win it all again for the third consecutive year. But take note, folks, this fall race at Talladega has been his Achilles heel over the years. Aside from the second place finish here last year, he has had five very poor finishes, including four DNFs in October. Boy, would that ever shake up the points today. Take a look at our starting grid. Congratulations to 32-year-old Travis Quaffle, becoming the third first-time pole winner in 2008. Casey Mears on the outside of row one. Tip and a half to the DEI boys, qualifying all four cars in the top 10. To win here at Talladega, all the pieces of the puzzle must fit together perfectly. To explain, here's Jamie Little.
Well, Doc, one of the major pieces of the puzzle is getting onto pit road here at Talladega safely and effectively. First of all, because you can't see through these new cars very well, it is essential that the guys use their left hand out the window to signal to their competitors they are coming onto pit road. Now, I talked to Matt Kenseth right before he got in the car, and he told me because you're going 200 miles an hour here at Talladega, dropping off turn four to come down to pit road, it's essential that you find a spot on the track to mark in your head to say, this is where I need to back off to get down to that 50 5 mile per hour speed limit on pit road. So with that said, he put a piece of tape on his dash that says first slash. He said it's all about taking care. You don't want to lock up your brakes. You don't want to slide your tires. Take care of your equipment. Get in your pit box. Shannon Spake.
Well, Jamie, another piece of that puzzle, the spotters all the way above the track. Very important member of the team here at a restrictor plate race. Now, spotters, they use some tools in order to help them do their job a little bit better at a restrictor plate. Cell phones in order to text message other spotters, binoculars so they could see their drivers on the track, and scanners. Joey Meyer, spotter for the number one of Martin Truex Jr., he told me he carries four of these so that he can listen to other teams, see how their car is handling in the draft. Now, Meyer also told me, he said, quote, it's my job not to screw up. I can't win the race for my driver, but I can lose it for him. Dave?
Shannon, all up and down pit road and behind the pit boxes, there are pieces to the puzzles that are the race cars. Now, how many puzzles have replacement pieces? These guys do. If they have contact on the racetrack, they will have to put these pieces on and try to get their cars able to keep the minimum speed back on the racetrack. Mike?
Dave, with the draft being as critical as it is here in Talladega, there could be plenty of politicking going on today. Drivers trying to form alliances, looking for a drafting partner that will push them to the front. But as the intensity ratchets up, those deals could merely become verbal contracts made to be broken. As one crew chief told me, deals are simply a fairy tale because no driver, Doc, wants to finish second.
43 drivers have visions of victory here today. 12 are also dreaming about a championship. Could Talladega be the turning point for some in their chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup title? 500 miles of hold your breath, white knuckle stock car racing, folks. This is Talladega. Almost a complete lap to get these restricted engines up to speed, and during that first lap it looks like a moving parking lot. They are side by side almost in qualifying spot until someone like there in the back, that's Jamie McMurray, moves out to make it three wide.
These cars are fast, but they have that restrictor plate on there, and it takes a while for the car to accelerate up to full speed. By the time they get here to turn three, they're just about there, but it'll take just another half a lap or so before they get those last couple miles an hour.
Yeah, you'll see them start getting to each other's bumper, and that's whenever they really start picking up speed and doing what we talked about, the draft, and it really works extremely well on these restarts because that's what they're trying to do. And they start bumping each other, then it's really going to accelerate the speed for these guys.
Saw the 12 car, Ryan Newman there making his way to the back. Travis Quaffle, pole sitter, leads a first time by.
I see why everybody was so excited on these Sundays now that I'm up here. I understand why everybody around me was so excited. The drivers, you're always apprehensive about this, as we talked in the pre-race show, just being a little bit concerned. Right here, we're seeing some bump drafting taking place. Mike Wallace in that 33 car. This is the first time he's been in that car. Joe Nemechek there right in front of him.
That is first through fifth. 28 left side of your screen. Then the 8 of Almirola, Paul Menard. That outside line starting to move back up there. That's Casey Mears, his best starting spot of the year.
That's what I love about this racetrack. You got a lot of new guys at the front. Travis Quaffle leading the race. There's Eric Almirola second, and then Paul Menard right there in third. These guys are having fun up front.
Yeah, they are. And, you know, it's always so strange. You start this race out, that inside line moves, and even though the guys on the outside are lined up somewhat, they just can't seem to make it. But they'll start making their charge back, and that's where we're going to be two and three wide, just like you see right here.
Strategy taking place here for Jeff Gordon. No surprise what he did here a year ago.
Now, don't panic. He's not. There's nothing wrong. He's probably just trying to find a spot he's comfortable running in without getting in trouble. He's being very patient right here.
Yeah, he's already seen something that he didn't want to be a part of at this point in time of the race. This is a long, long 500 miles, and I can't begin to tell you how much patience it takes to make everything happen that you want to happen throughout the day.
You Dale Earnhardt Jr. fans, remember the backup engine and the backup car started at the back of the pack, and there he is making his way by one. Said he was going to try to get there if he could safely early on.
There's an old drafting buddy right in front of him, Tony Stewart. These guys know how to draft together.
Yeah, they do, and he hasn't wasted much time. We see a pass for the lead now.
Mike Wallace.
That's a Richard Childress fourth car in this race. Got Rich. Brian Vickers right behind him.
Little bump drafting for the Red Bull boys behind them, 83 and 84. That's Vickers and Skinner.
You can see right there where Brian Vickers hit at the 33 car and just pushed him by Travis Quaple there on the inside.
And Mike Skinner's a drafter too, buddy. He knows how to run these restrictor plate races.
Yeah.
Drivers were warned in the drivers' meeting this morning. Bump drafting is okay, but not in the turns. It can get out of hand in a hurry. Shannon.
Mike Wallace in that fourth RCR car. I spoke with his crew chief, Shane Wilson, who, of course, came over from the Nationwide Series. He said that this car qualified without the aid of a qualifying setup, so they were in race trim. And, guys, they said that this car is the real deal. They are here to race.
Shannon, I talked to Richard Childress yesterday. He said this is what they're looking at for 2009. It is a brand-new R&D car and an R&D Chevy engine. They decided to run with the driver, not in the points, to see how it would perform at Talladega. And thus far, it's getting a pretty good grade,
yeah,
Andy.
Yeah, so far, so good. And this is the way you do it. You just stick another car out there. This is the time of year that you want to prove some of these packages going into the next season.
Yeah, they're all taking their shot, but Travis Quaple and that Doug Yates Ford with Todd Parrott setting that thing up still be able to hold all of these guys off right now, and the low line's working.
Third car in line is Paul Menard, who's made a lot of news this week, but would like to be able to give back to DEI with a good run here today. Jamie.
Well, he sure would. We saw him running top 10 last weekend, running third right now. He actually announced this week, as you mentioned, he is going to the Roush Yates stable. He will be teammates with Travis Quaple, your leader. He wants nothing more than to go out on top with DEI, prove that he's worthy and that DEI is worthy of winning here at Talladega. Dave.
His worthy teammate, Eric Almirola, is right in front of him in that 8 car. Talked to Tony Gibson, the crew chief, this morning. Said he's really got a great race car, but he's a rookie. DJ, what do you do with rookies at Talladega? Do you follow them or not?
You usually hang them out when you get the chance. But, these guys do have some experience, and so you'll work with them as much as you can at this point in time of the race.
And Paul Menard knows how to race here.
Look at Jimmy Johnson. He has said, you know what, you guys can wreck if you want to. I got a great place to be back here until it is time to make a move.
That's pretty far back there.
That's too far back for me.
Said
he
you
was
can't
concerned
hang
about
back
that
at
car.
Daytona. Said you can't hang back at Daytona. You'll get lapped at Talladega. As long as you can see him, you should be okay. We'll find out if anything else is going on when we come back in just a moment. Aerial coverage from high above Talladega Super Speedway brought to you by our good friends at Goodyear. Get there on silent armor technology with the strength of Kevlar for toughness and a comfortable ride. Right now it is Carl Edwards who has a very comfortable ride. He was the leader. He's been shuffled back out. Now Brian Vickers has gone by, so we have had now three leaders in the first 9 laps.
See another guy up there that finished second in the first race here, Juan Pablo Montoya. He was running second, but got shuffled out there. They kind of split him.
99 and 17 up high. If he just joined our coverage, Travis Quaple led the first 8 laps. Then Carl Edwards led a lap and got shuffled out. Brian Vickers now showing the way. Let's check in on Carl Edwards. Mike.
Well, guys, as nerve-wracking as it is, you would imagine, coming here on a regular basis, imagine being in the championship hunt and having to come here. Well, that's the case of Carl Edwards. He actually said earlier this week he'd pay $1 million just to come home with a top 10 finish. And, you know, that gives you some perspective as to how hairy things can be here. He just wants to survive.
Mike, he's been here 8 times. He only has 1 top 5 finish, that coming a 5th back in the fall, this race in 2005. He said he has trouble with getting people to work with him and help him in the draft here, but able to, and you got to have friends here to be able to draft up in this field.
It certainly helps, and, you know, having a good race car
makes a big difference. You know, we see all of these guys battling. Here's Jimmy Johnson, and he is way back. He is 17 seconds off the pace right now. Dave?
And DJ, I asked Chad Knaus, his crew chief, how long do you want to wait in this race before you go forward? He said not until the very end, like 12 laps to go. But this is not what they intended. He lost the draft early. Here's what he recently said on his radio.
I just told the 5 and the 24 we probably going to need some help here.
We need it, man.
But we're okay. I just talked to him.
And Jimmy said, I'm trying as hard as I can, believe me. And what he means by help from the 5 and the 24 is for his teammates who don't want to race at the front of the pack all at the early part of this race to fade back, slow down, and pick him up. And as a group, draft back toward this pack. But he can't afford for the pack to come around and lap him.
Dave, the 5 car of Casey Mears had qualified second, was running in the top 10. And once they got that radio communications, now Mears is slowly dropping toward the back. He is back in about 34th or 35th spot. There's the 5 car, I guess, trying to work his way back toward Jimmy Johnson to give him a little bit of help.
But even there, Jimmy Johnson is still way behind this. He's 10 seconds behind the 96 car, who is in turn 6 seconds behind the last car in the lead pack. So he's lost the draft now. He's just going to have to count on a caution flag at some point in time if he's going to get any help. Because even if they drop back there now, they're not going to be able to help and run fast enough, Andy.
Yeah, these cars, they are so big. These new cars make so much drag that it's hard for these back guys, the guys at the very tail end of the draft, to stay up with them. And if they lose a couple or three car lengths, then they're gone and you've nothing you can do about it. And that's what's happened to Jimmy right here. The same thing happened to Kenny Schrader. He's now dropping back. The best thing that could happen right now is for these two guys to help to get together, maybe help each other, but that's probably not enough.
And it's still not enough because as we see a pass for lead, Eric Almirola going around Brian Vickers with the help of his teammate Paul Menard here. But Jimmy Johnson, at this pace, he's about 2 seconds a lap off of what these guys are running. So in 25 laps or a little more, he's going to be lapped. Dave?
And let's remember why the 48 was at the back of the pack to begin with. Early this morning when they first came to the garage area, they asked the NASCAR officials if they could go under the hood of the 48 car and check the cylinder walls. Jeff Andrews, head engine builder for Hendrick Motorsports, took a scope and a light and looked inside the cylinder walls to see if there was any chafing, any scraping of the pistons on the cylinder walls, because that's what befell the 88 car on Friday. He didn't find any evidence of that, but NASCAR said you can look, but we're going to have to start you at the rear of the field.
A lot of concern back there. They're still probably 25 laps away from pit stop, so they need definitely going to need some help with the yellow flag. A little bump drafting. There's a 31 car of Jeff Burton on the bottom of the racetrack. Kurt Busch has had two great finishes on restrictor plate tracks this year, second and fourth at Daytona in February and July.
I'll tell you, if I'm Chad Knaus, I'm really worried right now. This the 48 car is way behind this pack. Cars maybe suspect, maybe something wrong with the engine, and maybe that's why they lost the draft. Maybe there really is something not ticking right in that car.
Yeah, there could be something there. Or I mean, if he just had to get out of the gas a split second back there, we see the outside line moving here with David Reagan up there right now. This is going to happen all day. They're going to be back and forth as to which line is the best one to be in, and that's what you're going to have to choose. You see a little bump drafting there. Travis Quaffle into the back of David Reagan gives him a little shove towards the front.
DJ, the bump drafting with the new cars they have this year, is it better or easier than it was with the old car?
Well, the bumpers line up better, the front and rear bumpers, and so you can actually give them a pretty good shot and sends the guys out. What these guys have to do is just make sure they're utilizing this at the right places. Right here is not the right place in this triode.
NASCAR warned him about that yellow line as well. You cannot go below the yellow line to pass. You can go down there if you're forced there to avoid contact, but you cannot advance your position. See them all hugging the yellow line? Right now it is the rookie, Eric Almirola, leading at Talladega. You're watching ESPN on ABC. Can you make it on the wild ride? Take a look at our AT&T Crew Chief Challenge. Which chaser will get their first Cup restrictor plate race win here today? Will it be Carl Edwards, Clint Bowyer, Matt Kenseth, or Denny Hamlin? To play, text the word CREW to 191 on your AT&T wireless phone and send in your answer. The results will be shown later in the race. Standard text rates will apply. Riding along with the 31 of Jeff Burton. And the upper lane starting to get some momentum back, guys.
Got the 88 car in that lane, and he's moved way up in that field. He made a lot of headway so far.
Yes. Again, that's Mike Wallace in Richard Childress's fourth car in the 33 up at the front of this, riding along with Junior right here. These guys get, and when they get to the front, what happens, David Reagan, we saw, was in that outside line, and he jumped down to the bottom to get in line there. So then that slows that outside line down for a minute, and then they start making their way back towards the front, and it takes a couple of laps for all of that to happen.
See Jeff Gordon now pushing Mike Wallace in that outside line. We saw him kind of play the patient deal right there at the start of the race, but now he's starting to move back forward.
Yeah, he is, and now Mike Wallace jumps down to the inside, so Jeff is the first car there. Got Tony Stewart on his bumper and Kurt Busch right behind him. So just be a game these guys are going to play all day long, and as we ride along here, you see a little bit of a push from Tony Stewart. You can see that yellow line there, and these guys cannot go below that yellow line to make a pass. If they go there and attempt to make a pass, and obviously in the corners isn't where they're going to be doing it, but right here as they come off of four, they cannot get below there and advance their position, or they're going to get penalized.
And the other thing is you cannot force someone below that line without getting a penalty.
NASCAR told them in the meeting, if you go below the line and you're forced down there, you will not be penalized, providing you do not advance. You can give that position back and fall back in line. Big concern over the 48 car for Jimmy Johnson, and there is Chad.
Yeah, he's saying drag the brake. He wants the 96 car, Kenny Schrader, to come back there and help him. Dave?
Yep, and he was the closest one to Jimmy Johnson. Jimmy said, if Ken isn't comfortable being pushed around the track the way his car is handling, then we'll do something different. But for now, if you can show me a wide shot there of the 48 and the 96 car, we can tell how close they actually are together at this point. Because the idea was for the 96 to be in front, but he is now behind. Schrader is trying to push the 48 around. That's the only car back there. But as for teammate Casey Mears, they were trying to help as well and fade back, but they figured they needed about half a dozen cars to really help their teammate Johnson to make this work. So that's why the 5 hasn't gone all the way back. Listen to the recent radio on the 48.
I've been working with the 96. He said he's going to come back and get us because they're kind of in the same boat we are. So we can run 2x2.
And guys, that's the whole thing. It's 2x2 right now. Here comes the pack. They're going to overtake him. And then Jimmy will have to hope that he can get the free pass at some point when there's a caution.
88 car up on the high side. David Gill in there. Remember, Earnhardt Jr.'s come all the way from the back of the pack. Three lanes coming up off the corner. Gordon in the middle. Gillen and Jr. up high.
If they're getting ready to run up on these two slower cars, you can see Jr. really giving a nice push to David Gillen there. And that goes to the inside of him.
Pulled down in front of his teammate, Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, they're going to run up on these two slower cars.
35 car pack moving in on Jimmy Johnson and Ken Schrader. And there comes the leader, David Reagan, flashing by, and will put Jimmy Johnson and Kenny Schrader a lap down. DJ, you called it in 25 laps.
Yeah, well, the good thing for Jimmy Johnson is there's a long way to go in this. The thing that he can't do now, obviously, is get swept up in a wreck. But, you know, we will have a caution before this day is over. Just look at that group right there. It could happen at any point in time. But he will be the first car lap down at this point in time. So, again, 25 laps down of 188.
It's going to be interesting to see now if he can actually maintain in this group, see if his car is okay. If his car is okay, he'll be fine. But if it's something wrong with it, he may not be able to maintain his position in here.
Yeah, you can see he's fallen in there in that third spot, so he could actually drive his way back to the very front here as he gets some push, a little bit of a push right here, and that's what he's trying to do is get that thing going back. He'd like to be in front of these guys. He doesn't want the lucky dog. He wants to be in front. He's making a charge to that right now.
His teammate Dale Earnhardt Jr. now giving him a little bit of a push, trying to get him back up there, and he has pushed him by.
Looks like his car's fine, but here goes Jr.
Jr. wants to, he's got the lead now.
Didn't take him long, boys, from the back to the front.
Yep.
How's that for an Earnhardt? From the last starting spot to the lead in 26 laps at Talladega. We've seen that before, I believe.
Yes, sir, we've seen it before. These Earnhardts know how to restrictor plate race. Listen to them.
They are excited here.
We talk about the last fan standing. They are on their feet here in the Earnhardt Nation at Talladega. Dale Earnhardt Jr. becomes the 6th different leader here in the AMP Energy 500. He has won 5 times at Talladega. Could he do it today? Back after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Dale Earnhardt Jr. currently leads the AMP Energy 500 at Talladega, working lap number 30 as they flash by. Give a call to David Reagan there in the sixth car. He was with the other car, aside from the 88, that changed the engines and had to start at the back of the pack.
Yeah, both these guys made a charge to the front. Actually, Travis Quaffle actually led that lap. He passed Junior and just got by him at the start-finish line. But David Reagan and Dale Jr. have been on a mission to bring those cars to the front from the rear.
Shannon?
Doc, David Reagan was the highest finishing Ford back here in April, fourth place. It is the same car here that he had back in April. It's a big weekend for him. He's got his family here, and he's, of course, from nearby Atlanta. So he's got his parents, his brother, and some cousins up on top of that pit box. He is giving his family quite a show right now, guys, running very solidly in the top five.
Yeah, that car finished fourth here in April, finished fifth at Daytona in July. So a good restrictor play car, as evidenced by that move here early on in the first 20 laps.
This 28 car is strong, though. Travis Quaffle was able to take this car to the front. He's keeping it up there, too. I mean, it's one thing to get to the front, but it's hard to stay up there unless you have a really good car.
Yeah, it really is. And you see that the fourth car in line there on the inside, that's Jimmy Johnson, and he has a lap down if you just tuned in with us. Dave?
And DJ, that may yet be a very good race car as we watch the bump drafting down the backstretch. Just check with Jeff Andrews. He's a head engine builder for Hendrick Motorsports. He was the guy that checked out this motor this morning. I asked him if while the car was running around by itself, if he heard the sour engine note they sort of heard, the flat engine note they heard during qualifying yesterday. He said no. Jimmy lost a draft when someone got on the brakes early, and the fact that he's staying in the pack now, right now, Hendrick Motorsports are satisfied that the 48 might be okay if he can get his lap back.
Yesterday, I talked to Chad Knauss. He said, we have never had any luck here in October. We finished second there last year, but prior to that, we had five consecutive horrible finishes and four DNFs. Said this race has been our Achilles heel. And right now, he is one of only two cars, as you said a moment ago, a lap down, showing in 42nd position.
Watch this tachometer. You can see that these engines don't, they never back off the throttle. The RPMs do not vary a lot around the racetrack. They're running close to the same speed in the corner that they do the straightaway. Man, this looks hairy right here. I can see why you guys would get nervous about these races, man.
But it is exciting watching it from here, I can assure you. And that's why these fans fill the stands and everybody's tuned in watching here today, because it is such a great race, but it's just nerve-wracking from the driver's seat. You just never get to relax. They've got a grip on the steering wheel that they don't have any other racetrack.
Seven car of Robbie Gordon there had lost a draft. He will be the next car to go a lap down. And why is that important to Jimmy Johnson? Because he would be the first car if he could hang there somehow and would get the lucky dog, although this whole line may go by him as they're trying to on the outside.
There doesn't look like a gap for Robbie Gordon right here. He's just going to have to let these guys go. Really, Jimmy Johnson did a great job of getting himself in this spot. Caution's out. Looks like Jimmy Johnson will get the lucky dog spot.
Turn two. Some debris down at the edge of the yellow line where you're being told by one of the NASCAR spotters. That will bring caution out here on lap 33.
About Mike Wallace bringing him down here, the leader.
First NASCAR Sprint Cup start of the year for Mike, who is a full-time competitor in the NASCAR Nationwide Series. Currently sits eighth in the points in the Nationwide Series where he drives a Toyota. Here's a 70 car coasting down toward pit road. Tony Raines.
Yeah, pit road was closed, and he's already down here. Like something must be wrong with the 70 car. These guys are going to jack it up here and change tires.
Sounds like he might have had a tire problem or something like that. Can't imagine why else he would have been in, and that could have been part of the reason. Might be the debris from him.
The 7 car got the free pass, by the way. Robbie Gordon, I told you that was a concern when they made that pass a moment ago. And when the caution came out and the field was frozen, Robbie was in front of the 48. He was the first car lap down, and he gets the free pass.
Well, it's all about the time that thing came out, because these guys, the leaders, went past the 7 car really fast. So that caution had to come out just at the right time for the 7 car to get it and Jimmy Johnson not to get it.
We just joined our coverage. This is the first caution flag today. There have been 7 different leaders, 8 lead changes. Travis Quaffle, the pole sitter, has led twice for 10 laps. David Reagan on the back of the pack in the 6th car has led 9 laps. Earnhardt Jr., 5, Vickers, 4, and Almirola, the first laps he had ever led in a NASCAR Sprint Cup race. Eric Almirola led 3 laps in the 8 car. Pit Pits will be open as they should peel off down pit road for the first time today. Pit road speed is 55 miles an hour. Pace car will run 70.
Imagine we're going to see a lot of two-tire stops here.
Yeah, you'll see a lot of two-tire stops, some gas and goes, and some four tires. Jamie?
And Matt Kenseth, second pit box at pit in. They just reminded him, just 55 miles per hour. Four tires, he said, free me up just a bit. The 99 almost put him in the wall, but he says pretty good. Shannon?
Jamie, Mike Wallace says the car is perfect. Four tires and fuel for that 33. Dave Burns.
On your screen, Dale Earnhardt Jr. gives up the lead for four tires, no chassis adjustments. Tony Jr. told me this morning, if we're going to take four, if we're going to take two cans of fuel, we'll take four every time. Mike?
The 28 team real happy with their race car. No chassis adjustments, just four tires and Sunoco race fuel for Travis Quappel. Little problem, though, on the left rear tire, a slow stop for Quappel. That will cost him.
Cost him quite a few spots indeed. You see Quappel back three spots. Kyle Busch up 12. Mike Wallace back three. And Martin Truex up seven positions. So most of the leaders opting to take four tires instead of two or none here on the first stop. Back in just a moment. Back at Talladega Super Speedway, NASCAR Sprint Cup Series action under caution for the first time today. And the 99 car actually stayed on the racetrack a moment ago. Mike, was there some confusion over whether he had led a lap or not?
Well, I guess that's up to us to decide. If you want to take the team's word for it, that was a calculated move. Their PR man just came over and told me they did not want to stop with the rest of traffic. They didn't want to take the chance of having the fenders get dinged up or anything like that this early in the race, with it being so easy to draft to the front. When they did finally stop, they freed the car up with a chassis adjustment. It took four tires and fuel.
Remember a week ago, he was a ping pong ball on pit road and got hit a number of different times. But then just a moment ago, there was also action on pit road involving David Ragan.
Yeah, watch this right here. This is why Carl Edwards didn't want to come down pit road. You see these guys coming out of the pit stall. David Ragan is trying to avoid the 70 car, Tony Raines, and just spins the car out on pit road.
He just missed the 9 car of Casey Kane.
Dangerous down there. The one thing that the 99 team needs to be careful of, though, is the same thing that happened to Jimmy Johnson. You know, yeah, you can stay at the back and you can still make your move to the front, but you don't want to lose the draft. And you know, don't take it for granted that you're going to be able to keep up back there if you're the last car.
96 car, Ken Schrader, too fast on exit. The double zero car held on pit road for excessive speed coming in. That's Kenny Wallace. We'll sort of that when we come back to Talladega in a moment.
Getting ready for a restart after a round of pit stops has really mixed up the running order.
Boy, it really has. You see Jimmy Johnson fell off the pace, fell back a little bit. Guys, I'll tell you one thing, it's making me really nervous for guys that are purposely dropping to the back, because right now, Ray, it looks like you're really barely able to hold on.
Yeah, and it's going to be a tough time coming back up through there. You're really taking a chance on something happening.
And did Carl Edwards really stay out, or was that a mess up? I can't believe that that's strategy.
Green flag, Jimmy Johnson will lap down to the inside of the leaders, Doc.
And Alan, we're being told now the 7 lost the free pass for putting fuel in twice. And by the way, you Bobby Labonte fans, he was caught for too fast exiting pit road. And you Kenny Wallace fans, he was held a lap. The double zero was clocked at over 100 miles an hour coming down pit road. NASCAR took a dim view of that and held him there for one whole lap.
Yeah, I don't know why he would be going that fast down pit road. It'd be interesting to hear Kenny's explanation. But we got some racing going on up front. See Jeff Burton trying to make a move to the inside. He'd like to lead a lap.
5 bonus points to lead. Now, it only counts if you can hold on until they get back to the start-finish line.
That's a long way from turn 4.
Yeah, there's times you think you've got that with no problem, but it's a long way. These guys can make a run back on the outside, but he's got a fast car and Jimmy Johnson pushing him. Burton will lead this lap. Dale Jr. is actually in second. That's Jimmy Johnson, who's a lap down just behind Jeff Burton.
So Burton becomes the 8th different driver to lead at Talladega. Back in the spring, there were 52 lead changes here among 20 different drivers. That's why the fans love coming here so much, and we love being a part of it.
Just shows you how quickly it happens. Going down the backstretch, just last lap, Jeff Gordon was leading this race, and all of a sudden, he's back there in the middle of a hornet's nest in about 8th or 9th, whatever you can pick out from there.
Jimmy Johnson is now on the tail end of the lead lap, right in front of the leaders, are trying to hang there. Looks like Dale Earnhardt Jr. would like to get by. But they got to be worried about that 17 car on the high side. Matt Kenseth going to go by.
And you have to wonder how much does Junior really want this 48 car on the lead lap if he's going to have to race him. He's the guy that you'll have to race for this win.
Yeah, not only for this win, but for a championship, too. And you know if you can keep him a lap down. So, yeah, they might be teammates, but there's also you got individual things in your team to look out for.
We asked Junior about his talented teammates.
It's been neat to be in that group and being a part of it. I've been having a good time, and they've been treating me really good. We raced really hard with each other, and we've got a lot of respect for each other. I've got a year under my belt working with them, and I feel like they still respect me as much as they did when I first got there. So I guess that's a good thing.
Respect and appreciation, but right now it looks like Jimmy Johnson has gone to the high side and left the front of the 88 car to move up in front of the Toyota of Vickers.
Got Matt Kenseth down on the inside. Kurt Busch and the two car. Shannon?
Well, these are two guys that really have nothing to lose. Kurt Busch not in the chase, just going for a win. And of course, Kyle Busch. I spoke with his crew chief, Steve Addington, who told me there are 11 guys in this chase coming into this race who are concerned about this race. We're just out here and we have nothing to lose. We can go for broke, and that's what they're doing here today.
Little Busch pushing Busch here. Brothers working together a little bit, Dodge and Toyota. Remember, it was Kyle Busch who won here back in April, also won the plate race at Daytona in July. And what about what we saw happen with the 99 a moment ago, where he stayed on the racetrack when everyone else pitted, then came back in? Mike?
Let's talk to the guy who made the call, Bob Osborne. Can you explain that pit strategy?
Well, we got 5 points earlier in the run there, so we were just playing it safe, waited an extra lap to not be in the melee of pit road for the first time. And planning on just riding around in the back for a while, so it was no big deal to come second time by.
Well, guys, you win championships by being innovative, and that's certainly a new one here at Talladega.
Carl Edwards talked about the fact that he's never had a lot of luck here, and he was going to go talk to some people, including Dale Jarrett and a few others, about that. How do you win here? How do you? Because you have such a good record here. Did you get some? Give him some advice.
Well, yeah, there's different ways of going about this, and you have someone like Carl Edwards. I mean, we know that. As a race driver, he wants to go wide open all the time. And that's the strategy with most of these guys. But sometimes you're just trying to get the best finish that you possibly can. And if you gave these guys the option to get out of Talladega with a top 10 versus going up there all day and racing and taking a big chance that they might crash, then I think they're going to take that top 10. And this might be a strategy that he's playing on, especially when he knows his closest competitor, or actually the guy leading the points, is a lap down at this point in time. He's on the tail end of the lead lap.
This looking like it's going to work for Carl Edwards because he's able to hold on to these guys. Jimmy Johnson, early in the race, not so much. I mean, he was not able to hold on to that lead grab.
The thing with these cars, you really have to pay attention to what you're doing because you lose it just a little bit, you can't catch back up. So you really have to be on your toes and make sure that you don't just jump out of the gas or anything like that because it takes so much longer for it to catch back up.
Talking about the differing philosophies of staying out of the big one, either be up front or get far and far in the back. And I guess Jimmy got so far in the back, he's up front again.
And just watching this 99 this last time by, you can see they're starting to catch back up now, but they had almost lost touch with the tail end of that field. But he's got some company back there to help him.
What about Tony Stewart, who has never won here at Talladega? Jamie.
Yeah, he's finished second 6 times, Doc. You know, before that last pit stop, he worked his way from the back to the front, but then they came in, took 4 tires, and they realized the tape was coming off the grill. They had to come back in, fix that tape, and he slipped back to 35th off that start. But he's already worked his way up. He's about 29th right now. But DJ Andy, maybe you guys can explain how much that tape impacts a car at this track.
Well, that tape's everything. You know, the drag, you put all that air inside the front of the car, it makes it, you know, makes a lot more drag, makes it a lot harder to run fast. So they made a good move there by putting that tape back on early.
Casey Mears up front. He was the highest finishing Hendrick car here in April. And now caution being shown for the second time today. Debris on the tri-oval area. That should give Jimmy Johnson the free pass and let him go back around now and get back on the lead lap.
Well, no, that's a sigh of relief there for this team.
I bet you he doesn't lose a draft this time.
I bet he doesn't. I bet he doesn't hang at the back as far. Be a little more aggressive.
Now watch Chad Knaus on the pit box. Said they needed some help, and obviously he's looking for it.
He saw it. He saw something. There's debris right there, boys. Yeah, these guys.
Think they got a vested interest in that happening?
Yeah, and I'm sure that NASCAR checked it out with a few other people before they believed Chad Knaus there, since they were the ones needing that. But obviously, there it is.
Yeah, there it is on the racetrack. He has great eyes.
When you need a caution, you'll be scanning that racetrack pretty good.
Caution for the second time today, and Jimmy Johnson will indeed get back on the lead lap. If you just joined our coverage, the reigning and two-time Cup champion dropped to the back of the field and lost the draft, and then the leaders ran him down, and he got a lap down. So he will now get the free pass back, and that will put now 40 cars on the lead lap.
Yeah, got a couple of guys up here in front. Casey Mears has made his way to the front with Elliott Sadler in second. Kyle Busch, who we haven't been able to talk about in the last few weeks other than problems happening, has made his way up to third. Of course, he won the first race here this year.
Well, what do you do, crew chief? Do they come now, or do you stay out there and hold on to that track position?
Well, you'll key off these leaders. If a lot of these leaders stay out, you'll see a lot of guys stay. But it wouldn't hurt just to come get fuel. If I was in this line, I would just come get fuel, because track position really is not that important here. You've seen how this works. Dale Earnhardt Jr. started 43rd, drove to the lead in, 20-some-odd laps. So it would probably be a good idea just to come on in here and get fuel. But some of these leaders, it's just hard to say what they're going to do here.
Yeah, and Bob Osborne thought that first time was going to be dangerous on pit road, just coming to get fuel and different things that these guys might do.
It really gets
wild then, doesn't it?
It's in and out, and everybody comes down pit road. 41 cars on the lead lap, but it's a quickie yellow. NASCAR says all of them can come on this lap.
They will be very crowded here as the guys on pit road. Kyle Busch's bunch, you see them all lined up. They pitted on lap 35, just 11 laps ago, so they won't need much fuel, but just a touch to top it off.
This is going to be interesting. We're going to see different strategies. I believe some guys might even opt to get right side tires. I don't know what kind of wear they might have seen here at the beginning of this race, but it'll be interesting to see exactly what happens. But this is going to get pretty exciting right now.
You can see some of these guys don't care about giving up track position. Bob Osborne actually stayed out on purpose to lose the track position. Jamie?
And Chip Bowen, crew chief for Matt Kenseth, said, I'm gun shy on the no tire thing. We're going to go with right sides only in fuel for Matt Kenseth.
On that last pickup, Kyle Busch added a piece of tape to that front grill, running a little hot. They're going to pull it off in fuel, Dave.
Casey Mears gave up the lead. Sunoco fuel and gone. Mike?
Mike Ford urging his team to hustle. No tires, just Sunoco race fuel and a track bar adjustment on Denny Hamlin's car.
There's the race off of pit road. Elliott Sadler gains a spot. Travis Quaple up 10 positions. Some of those took two right sides only. Got to believe one took fuel only, and Kevin Harvick stayed on the racetrack to get the 5 bonus points for leading a lap. Back after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
Before we go back racing, Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s Amp Energy National Guard Chevrolet got a little different look to it this week. 70,000 fans selected from an Amp Energy promotion to get their names on the car. Hendrick Motorsports Graphics Director Jim Gravelin spent about 80 hours developing a stencil for the wrap that they put on the machine by hand. Used his computer to place all the names. 5 test trials, 200 hours to complete. And Doc, somewhere among those 70,000 names, in addition, are your name, DJ's, Andy's, Rusty's, Brad's, mine. They're in there somewhere. I hear they're on the hood.
Actually, they're all underneath his name there at the left side of the door, right beneath where it says Dale Earnhardt Jr. Now let's listen into the radio for the 48 car for Jimmy Johnson.
Patience, sir. Didn't do anything silly. Or either we need to take gear out, which I know is impossible, or there's something prevent this thing from running like it should when I got somebody on my bumper. It can do some things at times, but it's just not, something's wrong. I'm going to try the B-box.
Listening to these other guys, just for what it's worth, the 88 just said the same thing about when he was leading that felt like the car just stopped, as did the 11.
So he's obviously feeling the car change significantly there in the draft.
Well, what happens is these air currents really are funny with these big cars and a lot of wind out there, and it can change the tone of that engine and make the driver think there's something wrong.
Yeah, definitely is different. It has how fast you're going and who you're hanging with and how much of a push you're getting. Go back to green. Elliott Sadler's the leader with Casey Mears on his bumper.
Elliott Sadler finished 6th in the Daytona 500. Had a great run to open the season here in 2008. Trying to keep that Gillette Evernham Dodge up front.
Well, now it's time for Kenny Wallace to be speeding. He's in that lucky dog spot. He was speeding on pit road, and they held him a lap for going excessively over the speed limit. So now he's got a chance to get that lucky dog back if he can race up here with these guys.
Little bump draft from Mears. Here comes Kyle Busch's Toyota to the high side.
I got a feeling he's not going to get much help there from Mr. Gordon, who's going to go with his teammate. Denny Hamlin's going to help his teammate in Kyle Busch.
The 12 car of Ryan Newman dropped a cylinder, is now headed to the garage area. We'll update you as soon as we know any more on what's going on there. And by the way, the 22 car of Dave Blaney having electrical issues. He is being shown now back in the 37th position. Let's go down and check in our ESPN Tech Center in Tim Brewer.
Jerry, this voltmeter right over here, if we've got about 13.8 volts, the thing's going to be sufficient. But an indication, talking with Nelson Crozier up at Nelson Specialties, when this tachometer gets real erratic, that's when the battery is literally out of power. That's the indication that when you're looking for, you need to come in and change the battery.
Yeah, these things won't run without volts. And it, the problem with these cars today is they have so many electrical components in there, from air conditioners, blowers. There's blowers all over these cars that it takes a lot of power to run them, and you can't run long without full charge in that battery or an alternator working. Now, this looks like the Kyle Busch we've seen all year.
Yeah, I thought that for a minute there, those two were glued together. It looked like he had a trailer hitch on there, and he was pulling the 11 car of Denny Hamlin along. But these two have gotten together and separated themselves for just a minute. It won't take long till the other guys get
back. They can't maintain that. See, you can see this. Actually, what it does, it helps these other guys gain momentum on you. And you'll see now Kirk Busch is going to go by these guys with help from Brian Vickers. And then now they look like they're unbeatable. This will happen all day long. You'll see these guys going back and forth. But the one constant up at the front has really been Travis Quaffle in 28. He's been able to stay up there pretty well consistently.
Yeah, he's done a nice job of driving that race car and getting himself in the right position. You see three wide all the way back for about 11 rows there.
34 cars, and there you see the 99 car back in Biffle. It's Edwards and Biffle back here. You see these guys, there's a 24. The one car down in there, the 8 car.
At the back of that pack, the 29, who stayed out and led a lap that last time, as you said, and then the 48's right there. He's doing his best to not lose this. He had to be the very last car, and that's the hardest thing, not to lose the draft when you're that, because you have no pushing help. But he's got himself in a pretty good spot here now.
There's the 21 of John Wood, fourth generation out of the Wood brothers family in Stuart, Virginia, making his start.
You can see just going off your screen there, it's the 19 and the 5 who were leading this thing whenever this restart began. And now they've dropped back to the back of this lead pack. I say lead pack, it's the only pack out there. We get here, it's just one pack.
43 car there, Bobby Labonte driving for the King, Richard Petty. Bobby inducted in the Talladega Walk of Fame last night.
Whoa, gets a big bump right in the corner. That can't be good, Dale.
No, that's not a good place to get that. You don't want that. You saw Jamie McMurray and Juan Pablo Montoya up on the high side go all the way to the front. Around these guys, they made the long way around and went to the front. Oh, trouble.
David Ruderman sideways.
Right rear tires up down on this 44. Oh, no, Jeff Gordon's torn up. Oh, man, this is going to kill him in points.
And he has nosed into the wall.
How bad is it? Get behind the scoreboard, can't see him.
Yeah, he's got fluid coming out. That's what they can't see. That's not good. It's either the
radiator. A lot of damage to the body, which is extremely important.
Got the right front really hard, left front. All right, let's see if I can get a TV shot. You to the garage. How's your steering wheel way off?
So the six-time Talladega winner having trouble here. Heavy damage on his Chevrolet after winning both races in 2007.
You saw the right rear tire was down on David Ruderman's car.
Yeah, it looked like he blew a tire right in the middle of that pack.
Right, about a quarter of a turn.
See, everybody's kind of, even though they are three wide and jockeying for position, it was actually fairly calm.
See Ruderman right in the middle of your screen there. Jeff Gordon just behind him. See if they make some contact here. There's really nothing happening right there.
There it goes.
There's the tire.
The tire just exploded, almost just like what we saw Friday on Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car.
Oh, he came right across the front of Gordon, who then went into the outside wall. He didn't hit the 44 car. He might have just grazed him, but I believe then he was
we could get another shot. I think we'll see Jeff Gordon hit the
John
outside
Wood
wall.
Is also yeah, look, the ball.
He veered to the right to dodge a 44 coming across his nose and looked like he might have had a bump. We'll see him turn into the wall.
Yeah, I think he just these things, when you make a hard turn like this, you just lose control of them. Now, let's see. Right there it is. He has to make. Yeah. There's nothing you can
so
do.
So close.
You have to turn to miss him, and then you just lose control of the car.
Okay, get your stuff together there, Steve.
Now watch the 48 car get some debris here.
Spin in front of you.
That's it. Whoa. Piece of that tire. That's a pretty big, heavy piece. It could have done some damage to this 48. Still hung on the car. Also, Dale Earnhardt Jr. looked like he just snuck by the 24 car when he was coming off the wall.
24 car headed behind the wall. Dave.
And Jerry, they were going to repair the car on pit road, work on the front left fender on that car until the radiator was called, as Jeff is leaking out the front. The guys check that out. They will go to the garage. Pit stops happening on pit road, guys.
99 car came in early. Carl Edwards, Shannon.
Kyle Busch pulls his 18 car in pit stall, guys. He's off.
Boy, a near miss there with David Gill. Here's a 31 car of Burton. Mike.
And they just completed service on the right side of the car, looking at a four-tire change, also a chassis adjustment on Jeff Burton's car. They're off the jack and away, Dave.
And it will be a four-tire stop for Jimmy Johnson. Looks like he has a scrub on the top of the hood, but no real damage. They're checking to make sure the airflow is okay on the front of that race car. Rod Malik, the car chief, shouting for some tools to go over the front. Now they are going to make some repairs on the front of that car. A splitter brace is broken on Jimmy Johnson's car, so the problem's continuing for the championship leader coming into today's race.
The number two car, Kurt Busch, on pit road right now. He's got that hood up. They are having engine problems. He says he feels like the engine is just missing. They gave him four tires. They're going to check those plug wires, make sure that everything is good. They are going to send him back out, according to the crew, just to see if there's any problems right now. Kurt Busch, those guys just looking a tough hit for Penske Racing. Of course, the 12 team already behind the wall today.
It looks like they've got some kind of problem that's affecting both teams with the engine.
We mentioned a moment ago the 99 car also came on pit road when the pits were closed. Carl Edwards, and he will have to go to the tail end of the longest line for pitting early. Working lap 56 here at Talladega Super Speedway, the Amp Energy 500 under caution for the third time today. Jeff Gordon, the six-time Talladega winner and 12-time restrictor plate winner, is in the garage area with heavy damage to his Chevrolet. Jimmy Johnson has been on and off pit road to try to get a splitter brace repaired on the front of his car, where he caught some of that debris from the tire that let go on the 44 car of David Rudiman. Let's check in now where Jamie has caught up with Jeff Gordon.
Right now, if it stays the way it is, he will lose three positions in the points to ninth, but it's not over yet. Jeff, you're out of the car. Is there any chance we'll see it back out on the track?
Oh, I'm sure we'll get the DuPont Chevrolet back out there. I mean, you know, there's still a lot of laps left and no reason for us to not try to get out there. A lot's going to still happen, but no chance of us winning this race and making up any points on anybody, that's for sure.
We're going to show what happened here. If you want to watch our monitor, Jeff, take us through it. What's that like here, going about 200 miles an hour?
Yeah, you know, we got shuffled to the back. You know, we're trying to get together as teammates, and it just wasn't working out. And so I was all the way in the back. And the 44, it looks to me like he just cut a tire. I mean, he just turned left out of nowhere. And I tried to avoid him. And when I did, the car turned to the right and just lost control into the wall. So pretty much it's going to end our day for any. You know, we had a great car. Great pit stops, and everything was going the way we wanted it to go, and unfortunately we got shuffled back there, so that's part of Talladega.
Well, Steve Letarte, your crew chief, he's rallying the Rainbow Warriors. They're back here frantically working, trying to fix that front end damage, Doc. The splitter is dragging on the ground. They're going to try to repair that, cut off as much, because as we keep saying, it's not over till it's over here at Talladega. They could still salvage some points.
Jamie, he came in sixth in the points here right in the middle of the 12, and the 99 car has been on and off pit road a couple of times. Mike?
And it's their approach, Doc. They continue to be cautious. They thought they might have gotten a piece of that incident out on the racetrack. So Bob Osborne called Carl down pit road. They want to take a very good, close look at the nose of that car. On the exterior of the car, they saw no damage, got them back out on the racetrack, stopped a second time, this time so that they could pop the hood and look on the inside of the nose. Again, it checked out clear. They feel like they may have escaped what could have been a disaster.
It's all about dodging the bullets here on the high banks at Talladega. Here's where the chasers are in points right now. Carl Edwards atop the point standings, and where they're restarting, you see Jimmy and Carl back in 33rd and 35th. You see Kyle Busch in fourth and his teammate Denny Hamlin, who have done a great job of drafting together with those Toyotas, getting set to restart. Let's listen in as we go full throttle.
Gotta be hard to see.
Still covered high. No help in the mirror. Still out there to six. Still out there. Still out there. He's gone back a little. 38's out there with him. 66 with you, little bump.
Boom.
There you go.
In a little hole.
Still one outside on your sight. He's clear by 15. One outside. The 20 and 33. No pressure behind the 22.
On your bumper.
Couple of Richard Childress teammates you saw a moment ago. There is the 31 car looking back from Kevin Harvick. Harvick and Jeff Burton being shown in 16th and 17th position.
Hit Eric Armirola. You see Sterling Marlin getting a big run on the bottom, having a great run so far.
Sterling in the 09 car. Wow, they are really jammed up on the bottom of the racetrack, and now the high line beginning to move.
Looks like somebody in that lower line had to check up a little bit. It really caused this inside line to lose a lot of momentum.
Yeah. All it takes is just a little bit. You see Denny Hamlin once again being able to push a car. Now he pushes Bobby Labonte in front. Now he's going to try to take that lead away from him.
Trying to get down with a little more Toyota help with Labonte in the Richard Petty's Dodge. Labonte, of course, a winner here back in 1998.
We've seen this here the last couple of races. Denny Hamlin really be able to make some pushes with some guys to push them to the front. We see these guys separate, like Travis Quaggle there, got to the bottom of the racetrack and actually got off the racetrack just a little bit. Dave?
And the 43 of Bobby Labonte having a pretty good run today. No tires on that last stop. The stop before, same thing. They made a wedge adjustment two stops ago because Bobby couldn't run the bottom of the racetrack. It appears that's where he's running right now and maybe working better for him.
We got all kinds of things happening up here. Mike Skinner to the front in the 84 car with Casey Kane on his bumper.
The two car of Kurt Busch has moved behind the wall. So we'll update you on what's going on there with the two car. And his teammate Ryan Newman has had his troubles. He's with Jamie.
Tough day for Penske Racing. What happened, Ryan?
Something broke in the engine. I was trying to avoid Kurt coming off pit road, and it shut off, and then it just never cranked back up. And when it did, the guys worked their butt off to push it started. It was on six or seven cylinders. It broke something in the valve train, and it's pretty much junk. The Altel Dodge is done for the day.
Dreams broken for the Daytona 500 winner, guys, and I hear the two cars on his way back.
And shuffling up toward the front of the pack again, there's Casey Kane in his backup car. McMurray in the 26 car getting some help there from Kyle Busch in the middle line.
Now Reed Sorensen's got the lead. His lead swaps three or four times a lap.
You know, I'm going to tell you something. As crazy as it looks sometimes from the seat in those race cars, this is a lot crazier than what I ever saw.
We have had 22 lead changes among 17 different drivers, and folks, we're not even close to halfway yet.
Those are the official lead changes. This is the ones at the start finish line. See, it's changing again right now in turn one and two.
You know, whenever they repaved this racetrack just a couple of years ago, it just became so smooth. We see Harvick getting a run here to the back bumper of Matt Kenseth, giving him that little bump.
Watch him go.
This guy, it almost made you feel invincible, like you couldn't spin the cars out or wreck or anything. We know that they can, but it just makes for such great racing. This is unbelievable right here.
Jamie Murray had to just pull out of the way. These guys are coming so fast.
Three by three by three. Wow, that's just great Talladega racing. Reed Sorensen on the bottom of the racetrack. Casey Kane behind him, McMurray in the middle. Martin Truex up high, who will lead this time by?
Well, Sorensen held on to the lead for that lap.
You know, we go into these in-car shots, Dale. These cars don't look very stable. I mean, it does. If you're looking out the window, it looks very stable until we go inside. This looks like it's not as easy as they make it sound.
No. The cars move around a lot. And these cars in particular, this new car, the air buffeting around. As we can see David Ragan in the back bumper of Jeff Burton there, who in turns hits Kyle Busch as they're moving forward. And that's all you want to do.
They're four wide.
Casey Kane's going the wrong way there.
Five wide at one point.
Casey Kane backpedaling now through that mess. Lost about a dozen positions, goes right back in front of the 88. Here comes Truex. A lot of speculation this week about the future of DEI, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, after the announcement that Paul Menard would leave. Remember, Mark Martin is already leaving for next year. Now Menard's leaving next year. They'll have four cars right now, three drivers and one major sponsor. But with runs like the one car in the head in qualifying, it could bode pretty well for next year for DEI.
Yeah, sure could. But that just take that picture right there, folks. You saw Martin Truex looked like he was going to lead that lap. Now, when we get to the end of this race and they're coming down to get the checkered flag, Jamie McMurray passed him right there, and it didn't look like he didn't have any chance.
High side, the 88 car with trying to push his former team, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, with Martin Truex around, and he will indeed be able to push him now back by the 29 car.
Yeah, these guys have worked together in some nationwide races to make that work for them, so they're going to give it a try here in the Sprint Cup Series.
You mentioned the passer at the start-finish line, which is down in turn one. I asked someone this week, why did Bill France Sr. build this racetrack with the start-finish line past the pit exit? He said because he thought it would be exciting to the checkered flag, and indeed, he was right. You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Look who we've got our hands on now. Napa Auto Parts. Napa. Get the good stuff. And Subway Restaurants. Subway. Eat fresh.
Back here to see if Edwards got through.
And the big one has happened at Talladega. Carnage all over the front straightaway here at the exit of pit road. Cars that have just been ripped apart. Martin Truex.
Blue on the 83, guys. Right front tire on the 83. Saw the rest of it.
The front of his car, number one, is gone. There's the 83 car of Brian Vickers. They were three wide. Back for about 30 spots. No room for anywhere to go.
We heard him say there that the right front tire might have blown on the 83 to create all of this situation. Just as they got to the tri-oval,
it's definitely flat. The car's going everywhere. We couldn't hardly keep up with where they were going.
David Gilliland, who had already gone to a backup car after being involved in that shunt on Friday afternoon with Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s right rear tire. Martin Truex had such a good car.
They're putting the red flag out now to stop because there's so much debris down here.
They will bring the cars around and stop them at the entrance of pit road. And good to see the drivers able to climb out. Dale Earnhardt Jr., by the way, is the leader. He had taken the lead just a moment ago before this happened. There's Brian Vickers.
These cars were all running so tight and so close to each other that, you know, they had to be touching each other. Maybe that's what happened with the right front tire on this 83. But, man, you just knew something was going to happen as close as these guys were running.
Here we go. You can see Vickers right there in the middle. He's up towards the front of the pack because Dale Jr. is the leader of the race.
Oh,
right there.
Man.
Yeah, tire blows.
Well, he just misses the 31. Nine cars involved into the 38.
Look at Bobby Labonte. He's fishing his way through that. I'm telling you, he missed two or three guys by inches. Then you see Martin Truex had a hard lick on that inside wall.
How did 31 not get hit here? Watch the car come across right to Burton right there.
Oh, that was goodness. Close.
Well, didn't we say in the top of this you had to be lucky? So that's one of those times it was lucky. You see Terry Labonte spinning down through there in the 45 car.
70 of Tony Raines involved.
These guys are just riding along in their draft.
Yeah. Well, Mark Truex, just a victim.
Yeah, he had a great car. He'd pushed Junior to the front here.
Harvick's view, looking across from the 29 car.
And you see Jeff Burton right there. He's on the bumper of Brian Vickers, but he's able to sneak by rule right there.
That is the Allstate Goodhands move of the race, the 31 car of Jeff Burton and the 29 of Kevin Harvick, two of the Richard Childress cars somehow making a move to be able to get by. Watch it again from the front angle.
When all of this happens, you're just sitting there trying to drive straight through and hoping that somebody doesn't come across, just like you see right there, and collect you in it. And it's just a matter of if it's your day and you were lucky to make it through when it happens that close to the front.
Sit under the red flag here at Talladega, Alabama in the Amp Energy 500. A 9-car wreck coming through the tri-oval that started near the front of the field. That one car you're looking at landed basically our pit studios right on the other side of that wall. And Martin Truex Jr. hit about 5 different times in that wreck. And yet, due to the safety advances in these cars, he popped the window net down. He popped out of the car. He wasn't too happy, but he walked away. It was amazing just watching that car come at us, the number of hits he took in that one wreck.
We saw this thing come from a way off. He was coming right at us. He kept hitting, kept hitting, kept hitting. Finally landed, like you said, Alan, underneath of us. But, you know, the inside wall really did a good job saving his butt right there. There's no doubt about that. But cars really tore up bad right now.
Take a look at our sprint monster moment right up toward the front of the pack. This whole thing started with the 83 car right of the screen.
Yeah, Brian Vickers, just right front tire goes down. I don't know if he got to someone earlier or something caused that tire to go down, but well, he took a lot of race cars with him. Unfortunately, it could have been a bigger wreck, though, as we've all talked about. Jeff Burton did a great job of staying out of that wreck, as well as Bobby Labonte and some of those guys. But poor Martin Truex was just in the wrong place at the wrong time.
We talked about Martin Truex a minute ago taking a lot of hits. Look at him. He's about to be number 4 into that wall. Then he comes down and hangs a left and hits the wall again. Jamie, 5 hits, but he's okay.
He's okay. He's kind of smiling when you walked out of there, Martin. How frustrating was that, and what did you see and feel?
Well, it's frustrating, certainly. I mean, we had a great car. The guys just got to thank everybody at ECR for their engines and, you know, all the hard work back at the shop. We had a great race car. We're out there towards the front, racing for the lead. I was having a lot of fun, you know, drafting with Junior and him, and the 83 was right there inside me, and his right front tire exploded. I heard bam, you know, bam, like a shotgun going off, and you know, just along from the ride from there. So it's unfortunate. You know, had a rough week last, and another one this week, but the guys are working hard, our cars are fast, and that's what really matters. So I'm pretty happy with that. Just gonna have a bit of a headache tonight, I think.
Well, it's good to see he's okay. Martin Truex Jr. led laps the last 2 weeks, but again, he is out. Shannon?
Jamie, down here with Mike Skinner, who pulled his car into the garage, and then you started working on this car with these guys. Do you think you're going to be able to get it back out?
I'm a truck driver. That's how we roll over there. But, yeah, Jimmy and these guys will get this Red Bull Camry back out. That was kind of a shame. We saw what was going on. We seen it happen and got it woed down and got into a car a little bit. I mean, everybody just started wrecking. And I don't think we was all that bad until a red car, I think it was a Budweiser car, I'm not sure, come down in front of us. And that caused a little bit more damage on a Red Bull Toyota here. But that was a shame. You know, a car was pretty good, just kind of biding our time. And, you know, our goal today was to miss that, and we didn't miss it. So we just get her patched up and do the best we can.
Yep, we will see Mike Skinner get back to work on this 84, help his crew guys out. Jamie?
And David Gilliland has walked out of the medical center. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. Just disappointed, you know. That's 2 tires that took out 2 of our cars this weekend, one in practice and one here in the race. So, you know, unfortunate. Our Ford drive one Fusion was pretty good today. We were just, you know, kind of taking our time, going from the back to the front and just kind of being patient. And, you know, just got involved in someone else's deal. So, you know, it's just nature of this track. You know, when stuff happens, the holes close up quick and just run out of places to go. So, you know, unfortunate. We got 2 tore up race cars this weekend from blown tires and, you know, out of our control. So, you know, a disappointing end of the weekend. We felt really good about coming in here and felt good about our chances. But not today. We'll have to get them next week.
Well, the 8's driver is always strong here at Talladega. Good to see he's okay. And the media over here talking to Brian Vickers. And, Brian, what did you feel?
I felt a bomb explode in my right front tire.
I mean, it sucks, you know, because, you know, just so proud of the Red Bull effort. All the guys back at the shop put together a great car, Toyota, great engine. We led a lot of laps today. We had a car that could run up front all day. I don't think anyone can maintain the lead. It was just a matter of you know, timing and who was going to be in the lead. Just coming down, went down to the tri-oval, and it didn't cut. It didn't, you know, go flat. I mean, it exploded. I saw the right front fender going through the air before the front of the car even dropped. You know, very similar to what happened to Junior in practice.
Unfortunate for Brian Bickers. Of course, his one and only Cup Series win came right here at Talladega. Alan.
All right, Jamie, thanks. Good to see all those drivers fine after the nine-car wreck in the tri-oval. Now, scanning back through the cars, sitting under the red flag, that's Greg Biffle's 3M machine there, and it's carrying something extra.
It looks like he's got a complete tear-off off of somebody's windshield. If you look to the right-hand side, Brad, it looks like the double zero car has got a whole front bumper underneath it or something.
He's got something shoved up under that bumper. It looks like the official's going to give him a little bit of help there. And the 55 looks like he's pretty good looking on the right side. Double zero's pretty straight, but Greg's carrying an extra passenger there.
Now, Carl Edwards was hanging around at the back of the pack along with Greg Biffle and a couple other guys. Remember, Edwards just kind of played that odd pitch strategy all day just to stay in the back of the pack. And Ray, as he picked his way through this wreck, being far back enough to react might have helped him.
Yeah, there looks like they're making a good call there. Plus, playing those video games. I'm sure he was just like playing another one there. But if you watch, he just slows down. He's on the brakes hard, which is good. Another good reason we run the big brakes on these cars. But you can see very, very difficult to see. This is where your spotters really got to help you, and you got to slow down.
I tell you, the visibility was very, very poor, like you see there. I mean, I've been in these things before where you go through the smoke, and you're just hoping when you pull out of it, Brad, there's nobody sitting there. You know what? Most of the time there is.
Well, I mean, what strategy by Bob Osborne and Carl here? I mean, they're taking their time. They're picking their way up through the field, just running their own race today. And it's paid off for them on pit stops as well as right now under the caution.
And Jimmy Johnson, one of the other championship guys who will remember got a lap down early, has made some pit stops to repair his splitter. Here's riding through this with Jimmy.
Boy, take a look at this, all the smoke. This is really tough on Jimmy right now. Spotter saying back off. He's on the brake. He's just really calculating his moves through there. He gets through. Man, that was a great piece of driving out of Jimmy Johnson.
Little nervous moment there for Jimmy's crew chief, Dave.
Indeed it was. He's looking at the replay now, and I believe Jimmy's first words were, "I can't believe we made it through that." And after the start to your day, Chad, I guess he should be surprised, right?
Surprised we're anywhere even close to being involved in it. You know, unfortunately, we felt in qualifying like the car just wasn't up to song the way we needed it to be, and we took a chance this morning and took the spark plugs out of it and looked inside of it, and the engine seems to be okay, but, you know, it's still not running the way it was on Friday. We don't know exactly what's gone on. You know, with the rules that they've got with the restrictor play races, they issue the restrictor play, issue the shocks, issue the rear springs, and any combination of those above, you know, can slow the car down. So we're trying to get it figured out, but you know, we're real fortunate to be in the position that we're in now, and hopefully we can stay in the draft and get what we need out of it. But it's still not running the way we need to. But, you know, we're just going to kind of ride it out and see if we can get this Lowe's Chevrolet in the top 10 and move on next week to Lowe's Motor Speedway.
There wouldn't be anything that with time on pit road you'd take the time to try to change out?
There's nothing that we can change right now that would do it. You know, it could potentially be a gear. It could potentially be an engine. It could even be the issued restrictor plate for all that matter. So, you know, and that's all stuff that ultimately you can't change right now in a good amount of time or even legally. So we just have to run through with what we've got and play the hand that's dealt us and move on.
Try to avoid that big stuff now. Mr. Rick Hendrick is up on the box as well. What a weekend you've had so far. You had to start with the 88 team having some issues on Friday. They've cleared everything now. How are you doing?
Well, anytime you come to Talladega, you know, it's a action-packed deal. So, you know, just hope we can survive. You just hold your breath every time there's a problem. And, but, you know, it's great racing. The cars are really equal. And just hope we can be there at the end. That's the plan.
Now, remember, he's got one in the garage being worked on and a couple that are still okay on the track. And the 5 car, don't forget about them, running very well today and no damage on them.
And Jeff Gordon, the one that's in the garage being worked on from an earlier incident, not this one. Amazingly, this 9-car incident that happened at the front of the field in a big pack, and none of the championship chasers were caught up in it. They all got through. So Dale Earnhardt Jr. leads. We are under the red flag at Talladega.
It's the hard knocks, it's the long shots, it's believing in yourself when you're all you got. You don't turn back. Rising up to see the last man standing.
Television's next great cop show has arrived. It is Life on Mars, series premiere Thursday at 10 Eastern, 9 Central, after an all-new Grey's Anatomy. Harvey Keitel, Michael Imperioli, Gretchen Mol, Jason O'Mara, Lisa Bonet star. It's the Life on Mars series premiere Thursday, October 9th, 10 Eastern, 9 Central, after an all-new Grey's Anatomy. That's the show about where the guy goes to sleep, wakes up, finds himself back in the 1970s. A little different twist on things there. A little different twist on things here in Talladega, too. A guy was racing for the lead 1 minute and blinked, found himself back in the garage with a torn-up race car.
Well, this is like Groundhog Day, then, isn't it? Because it seems like we see this scenario a lot.
They're firing up the cars. He's going to go back under the yellow flag. Meanwhile, Casey Kane is with Shannon in the garage.
Yeah, down here with Casey Kane, one of the drivers who was in that wreck. You just said to me, you asked me where the six was on the track if they were in it. He's your biggest competitor right now for that 13th spot. How important is it for you to get back out and just make up a couple points on him?
I think it's, you know, it's important. I'd rather go home at this point. My car's hammered, but let's see what happens. These guys will get it fixed, and we'll go out and try to get, you know, a couple spots depending on how many cars fall out in the next little while. And it's too bad. I was having fun. It was normal Talladega, exciting racing, and we just got caught up in a, it looked like a problem. I saw smoke and then, you know, which is obviously a tire, and then cars going everywhere. So it's too bad.
Casey Kane, not in the chase, guys, but like I said, 13th place is what he's hitting for.
All right, Shannon, thanks. So the field begins to roll off here, and they'll open pit road in a moment. We'll see some service on the cars, but 9 cars in the garage area after this wreck that started near the front of the field, and amazingly, none of the championship contenders involved in the accident. Dale Earnhardt Jr. leads. Juan Pablo Montoya is second. Kevin Harvick is third. Jeff Burton fourth. David Reagan is fifth. Casey Kane wondering where he might be in the order of things. You know, what's so hard to comprehend about these races is, as high stress as the drivers are, the situation they're under out there, Rusty, we're not even halfway yet.
No, we're not even halfway yet. Just like you said, I mean, there's already been a lot of incidents out there. I tell you, one of the things I'm concerned about, we saw Dale Earnhardt Jr. in practice blow a right rear tire. Then David Reutemann blows a right rear tire. So you're thinking there's something going on in the right rear corner of these cars. And then you see Brian Vickers blow a right front tire. So must be a lot of debris out there, guys.
About 12 laps of racing since the pit stops. Doc, we'll see what happens here when they open the pit road.
Yeah, Alan, a 17-minute red flag. And again, of the 9 cars involved in an incident a moment ago, 5 of them had led the race. Vickers, Truex, Casey Kane, McMurray, and Almirola. Those 5 had led this race in the first 70 laps. So we had a lot of contenders that go out here in this first big one of the day.
Yeah, these things are going to happen. These guys were just speculating about these tires going down. I think what's happening is just the close racing here and the splitters on these cars. We used to not have these, and now I think that makes a bigger difference in we getting some cut tires.
Look at the front of the 11 car. Now, I don't think he was involved in an accident. Is all that scraping there which says Camry? What's that from?
Oh, that's all bump drafting, Doc. They've been hammering each other out there trying to get these cars to the front. You'll see all these guys probably take on 4 tires because they ran through a ton of debris. After this wreck, I know they cleaned it all up, but I would still want to go ahead and get 4 tires. The field is kind of thinned out just a little bit. Jamie?
Well, Andy, you hit the nail on the head. Kevin Harvick in third position right now. Todd Barrier's crew chief saying exactly that. They wanted to take fuel only, but because of all the debris, they said, let's be safe. They're going to put 4 tires on that 29. Dave?
Jamie, Juan Pablo Montoya, who finished second here in the spring. They'll take on 4 tires. No changes to that car, just in case they ran through some debris. They want the tires. And 2 tires on the 88 car is all they want to keep that lead they've got. Mike?
Jeff Burton just narrowly escaped getting some damage. They'll look the car over, but it looks pretty clean. A 4-tire change scheduled. No adjustments on the 31. He's away. Riggs, Biffle, and Blaney stayed on the racetrack. Here's the race off. Menard up 7 spots. Loser there, Montoya. Remember, he finished second here back in the spring. And Reed Sorensen, who led just a couple laps a moment ago, back 3 positions. We'll be back with the restart at Talladega Super Speedway here in just a moment.
It's the AMP Energy 500 from Talladega Super Speedway. AMP Energy's driver, Dale Earnhardt Jr., is leading as we get set to go back racing after a 17-minute red flag from a 9-car wreck that happened toward the front of the pack. Quick summary on the day, our McDonald's race rundown of what has happened so far. Start of the race, Jimmy Johnson had some troubles.
Yeah, he just lost the draft, and he got way in the back, got lapped, finally got the lap back, got lucky there.
managed to get himself back up into the hunt. Meanwhile, Jeff Gordon caught in a bad situation.
Got in a bad situation. David Rudiman has a tire go down, cuts right across Jeff's nose. He turns right to avoid him, gets into the wall, dings up the DuPont Chevrolet.
And then the big one started with Brian Vickers up toward the front of the pack. He was racing for about the third position with Martin Truex Jr. And the big story here where this one's concerned, Ray, is that the championship guys got away clean.
They did. You know, being in the back was smart. Jimmy Johnson and Carl Edwards picked their ways up. All 10, all of us, all the chase guys, none of them were involved in the wreck.
It's amazing. On board Jimmy Johnson. Car's why, spinning.
Why they're in a chase.
He gets through it. Johnson running in 14th as we get set to go back racing here, and we're still shy of the halfway point in this race. Doc?
And we've had all this excitement and all this fun thus far. We'll show you where the chasers are restarting. By the way, remember, Jeff Gordon was not involved in an incident there. He is in the garage area from a previous accident on lap 53. There's where they will restart. Jimmy Johnson, the points leader in 14th spot. And while you look at that, we might mention that the 28 car, Travis Quappel, had to come back on pit road. They rolled a tire, had a violation there. The 55 had a commitment cone violation, Michael Waltrip. And the 44 car, David Rudiman's been on and off the racetrack. They have gotten that car repaired after cutting a tire, and he is back on the racetrack. Jamie McMurray just turning the head to the garage area as we go back to green. Dale Earnhardt Jr. coming on, took on only two right side tires, as did the 15 car, Paul Menard, and they sit 1-2.
Then we see the RCR cars right behind that, Jeff Burton and Kevin Harvick, Juan Pablo Montoya. Things will be a little bit calmer here for a few laps.
Yeah, I was getting ready to say, do you guys just say, okay, there's the big one. Now let's just chill out here a little bit. And yeah. It seems like it is a little bit calmer now.
Is there a rule that there can only be one big one per Talladega race?
No, trust me. No, we see this right now, and they're a little bit spread out. They'll get back to it hot and heavy here shortly. I've thought that before, that, hey, we've taken some out. Now everything can calm down, and we can race to the end. But it won't be like that for long.
Field coming down. Kurt Busch back in the race, by the way. The two car had gone to the garage area with some sort of an engine problem. You heard it sputtering, wouldn't run. He has been able to pull back on the racetrack.
So Kevin Harvick on the high side there getting past. Montoya had a nice push from Denny Hamlin. You see him try to go up, and they're going to.
Here we go.
These guys are
getting racy again here.
Promise you.
13th on back to about 19th spot there. You see Jimmy Johnson in the middle groove. Tony Stewart beneath him. Back up front. A change up front for the lead. Juan Pablo Montoya, who finished second in that car back in April, now takes the lead away.
Looks like nobody's able to stay up front. Once they get the lead, it's like they're a sitting duck. Dave?
Pablo Montoya has been very happy with his race car today, as he now will not stay up front, just like Andy said. But the car is very good, and the driver said before this last red flag incident, just need to take care of it. Well, he has been taking care of it, and they got lucky on that last incident. They were running on the low line right with Kevin Harvick, and that saved him that time. Mike?
And you just saw Denny Hamlin step out of line and make the big pass. Well, that may be in a product. Oh, trouble on the racetrack. Montoya gets shuffled below the yellow line.
Come on up and
we'll blend back in with that incident. But that was pretty close, Doc.
There you go. You're good. You're good.
Wow, how good was that?
What a move. Man, that was incredible.
That's the way it's supposed to work. And it's a good thing that happened right there, where there is a lot of room on the backstretch. That's the way things are supposed to happen, as he was forced down and then was able to get back in line. So no penalties, I don't think, forthcoming.
Safe to say he didn't crack the throttle, because he's still running third.
Yeah, that could have been the big one, too. Yeah.
Definitely could have been the big one for Montoya, if you watch this right here.
You see, he was going down to try to make a move and then gets forced down by David Reagan.
Now, what he needs to be concerned about would be maybe some contact on that right front. We already saw the right front tire blow on Vickers.
He didn't lose a spot.
He did not lose a spot in that whole exchange.
How about that? He headed toward Anniston and came back and kept his position.
Junior, here comes Stewart. Side. Stewart here.
Who's that we see getting ready to take the lead right there?
Is that Jimmy Johnson?
Wasn't he a lap down earlier? Couldn't hang on to
the
draft.
He said it wouldn't run?
Look at this mess here. Three wide. Kyle Busch back in the middle of that. Denny Hamlin. Look at the waving there. The signal's inside the car.
Well, you see, there's Denny Hamlin. He was the leader just a lap ago, and now he's back in the pack. Nobody can stay up front.
Let's listen to Juan Pablo on Montoya's radio.
Got hit. Warren, I was there. Still now, that was a freaking idiot. Could have got a huge wreck. What a moron.
The thing
on you. Look at his rear fender. Look at his rear fender. You know, the quarter panel. I'm there.
10-4, you're fine. You're fine.
Obviously, Juan Pablo, and rightfully upset. It could have been a big one, as he said. And that about the first time the 48 car will lead a lap today. If you just joined our coverage, he was a lap down on lap 25.
Yeah, we heard that radio exchange, and here's what he's talking about. He had a nice run there, and David Ragan moved down. Really surprised that David Ragan didn't get a penalty there for forcing him down there at that point in time. A little dangerous move, and, you know, a lot of times you can't understand everything Juan Pablo can say, but I think we all got the message there.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. back up front, trying to go to the outside of his teammate, Jimmy Johnson.
Yeah, he was going to jump down there in front of Jimmy Johnson, but he didn't quite have enough room to make that happen.
Six car on the bottom line. There's Jimmy Johnson, the middle line. Now he will pull up in front of Dale Earnhardt Jr. That is Mike Wallace.
We're seeing more contact in this race than we see at Martinsville. I'm still concerned about the 42 car's right front fender because he did get pretty good contact on that thing, and it is bent in some. If you look right around the top side there, it's bent some.
Yeah,
on my tire.
You can see a push here. Mike Wallace got up there for just a second, but he got shuffled to the middle. Dave?
And guys, when I talked to Chad Knaus this morning, crew chief on that 48 car, he told me it handled great in the pack. The car was awesome, in his words, and they made gains since they got here. You know, sometimes you get here, you have what you have, you can't improve the car, but Chad said we picked up some, and if they could just figure out if that motor issue is a real issue or not, 48 might have something for them.
And look at the 33 car on his own. That's the R&D engine we talked about from Richard Childress Racing. He told me it's what they're looking at for 2009. And DJ, before the race began, you looked over at us and said that 33 car could be the big sleeper today.
Yeah, Mike Wallace does a great job at these races. All you got to do is give him half a car, and he's got a really good race car here. And looks like he wants to be up front. And looks like that car is very capable of that, too.
What did Chad Knaus say? Hope we can just hang on and get a top 10.
Yeah.
Check this out.
You crew chiefs are all the same.
You can see Junior just glued to his bumper, pushing him out there.
Yeah, this is teamwork, really working good. You see, even in the corner, they're not really bump drafting, but they are touching. Right here, they're in the corner. You see, they're actually touching through there.
Yeah.
Here comes Tony Stewart.
Tony has not led a lap today. There have been 21 different drivers to lead a lap.
Here comes the freight train, though.
Wow, yeah. Look at Montoya back in the middle.
Tony had a nice run and went below by himself, below Junior and Jimmy Johnson. Then he was able to get the help from Mike Wallace to push him to the front. His first time in the front today. Jamie?
Yeah, pretty darn good for a car that was wrecked on Friday, and that big one for Tony Stewart. The team, Greg Zippidelli, did a great job with the team fixing this car. NASCAR allowed them to stay in the garage 2.5 hours longer than they were supposed to get this car fixed. They had a new splitter on it. He's gone from the back to the front to the back. Now he's leading for the first time, guys.
Make it officially 34 lead changes, 22 different drivers, and we're still 14 laps away from halfway.
Yeah, last lap by, Jimmy Johnson and Dale Jr. were first and second. That time by, they were 11th and 13th. So, happens in a hurry.
We got another tire. Somebody else has lost a tire. I don't know, can't tell from this shot who it was.
Looks like Mike Wallace.
Yep, the right rear on the 33.
And that will bring out caution for the fifth time today. Caution waving here to slow them down. Debris all over the racetrack from that tire that came off the 33.
We'll assess the damage. Two right sides and we'll assess damage.
They do have quite a bit of damage. You can see part of that tire laying there, but they do have these tires, as you've documented before, Andy, these tires blow out. They really create some damage.
All the damage you see from the on the car was from the tire blowing out.
Wow.
Wow. Right in front of these guys, too. Look at this. What a good job Mike Wallace does not to wreck and then take a lot of these guys out.
Yeah.
He doesn't even really get sideways. It just blows out and he just keeps going.
There's even more damage. You can see all of those aluminum panels and things coming out. So that's probably going to create as much problem for him as anything else.
See David Ragan going down to avoid the debris. Now here is Michael Waldrop picking up a part of that tire carcass that's bouncing off the nose of his Toyota.
Yeah, that does some damage, too.
Yeah, we saw that on the 48 car. He took one of those carcasses right in the front end and broke one of the splitters. Yeah, this is a lot of damage here. Yeah. It's even up on the roof and windshield area. Yeah, Michael, they gave Michael a hammer. He's working on it from the inside.
Mike Wallison, who had a great race car here in the 33 car, now trying to get this thing pieced back together. Crew gear for the 55.
Just above the windshield right there. Okay.
That's Chris Hall, the front tire carrier, giving us the shots there. They're trying to put that piece on the roof.
These guys are ready. They've got pieces already made in case something like this happens. They got these screw guns. They're self-tapping screws. They stick right in there, and they do pretty well. They'll hold this on if they get enough of them in there.
I get a couple more screws in it. We're going to stay down right here. We're going to have to stand him.
Yeah, you wonder why that would do that much damage, but you have to understand he was running 190 miles an hour, and that piece of tire is pretty heavy in itself.
Okay, go. We're going to go.
But that is a lot of damage to have been done by that on the hood and on the top.
Michael Waltrip, by the way, still on the lead lap, being shown right now as the final car on the lead lap in 29th spot. Jamie.
And Matt Kenseth said that his temperature's pegged about 290. They're going to take some tape off that. And on the right side, they're going to put tires and leave the left sides alone for the 17. Dave?
Juan Pablo Montoya liked running out front, top of your screen. They will take on two tires to try to keep their track position. Jimmy Johnson's crew was talking about two or four. Whether or not they've decided at this point, hard to tell. The two go back, and they will go for four. Mike?
Another team looking to keep his track position is the 11 of Denny Hamlin. Right sides only, and they're away.
Chad Knaus, no surprise, opting for four tires on the 48 car. Montoya getting two, losing a couple of spots. Nemechek up seven positions. We are under caution for the fifth time today. Still not even on halfway. Back after this message and a word from our ABC station. Just shy of the halfway point here in the AMP Energy 500 at Talladega. Aerial coverage brought to you by our good friends at Goodyear. Get there on silent armor technology with the strength of Kevlar for toughness and a comfortable ride. Let's talk about how the teammates work together here and use the air together at Talladega with our draft track. Teammates trying to get in the target zone.
Yeah, you hear us talk about these guys and then working together in the draft. Now you see the 88 car get on the bumper of the 48. He's trying to stay in that green part. That's the zone that he wants to be in right there, the sweet spot, if you will. Here's the air over these two cars. As they stay hooked together, watch them go by the rest of these cars. These other guys are everywhere. You know, they're not helping each other at all, but this is just like one car, and these two cars can go faster and make better time, and you see them put a couple of car lengths on the rest of this group. That's drafting at its best.
Let's talk to our in-race reporter, the car number 88, Dale Earnhardt Jr., currently being shown in second position.
Junior, Dale Jarrett, you got a copy?
Yes, sir.
All right, it's been a pretty eventful day. How's it going from your seat?
Yeah, it's been good. Got a great race car. AMP Energy on the hood, sponsoring the race, here in the guard, on the quarters. It's pretty cool. I think everybody's been pretty happy with how things have been going so far. We had some really good pit stops, been keeping me up toward the front. I think the pit strategy has been real good. Car's driving just fine, you know, we've been able to do whatever we need to do with it. Just all this going on right now is just a formality, man. You know, you never know where you're going to be on that last lap, and it seems like just about anybody can make any kind of pass they want to make, you know. So I cut this race about 50 laps and just go at it.
Yeah, it's going to get pretty exciting towards the end. Is it as hard to stay up front as what it looks like from our perspective?
Yeah, anybody can pass you whenever they want. If a guy's running second, it's because he wants to.
All right, good luck.
Hey, Tony Jr., Andy Petrie, have you got us?
Sure.
Hey, man, what's going on with those tires out there? You seen any issues at all?
Well, I mean, there's something going on. Our tire the other day was just, it had a small cut in it, but I don't know if the things are just running so tight that, you know, wheel wells could be cutting sidewalls. Anything can make this happen. It's just really strange this is happening in Talladega.
Yeah, because we're really not up against the limit of grip or anything like that. You don't expect to see tire problems, but, boy, we've seen some close racing out there.
Yeah, these guys are really getting on to it right now, but it's like Dale Jr. said, you know, you're kind of at the wheel of the guy behind you, where he wants to put you and what he wants to do with you. So hopefully we're in that position here at the end where we can do what we want to with him.
Okay, you got a wheel man back there getting it done for you, so good luck.
Sir, he's the best.
His teammate, the 48 car, by the way, Jimmy Johnson, back in the back of this group. Johnson had come on and off pit road. He'd been back in the pits with the 48 car. And Andy, with the 48 car, they were taking the rev limiter chip out of the A box for Jimmy Johnson. What were they trying to do?
What's happening here? These guys are running lap times that are 2 seconds almost faster than what they qualified. And it's really turning these engines a lot of RPMs. And you don't want to be up against a chip because that just basically stops the engine from gaining any RPM. See, they have to take the side window out. They go in there, it's just a little box. They take a little chip out. We might even get Tim Brewer to show us later what that is, but it's just a little module that keeps that thing from revving over what the limit they want it to rev. Let's go down and let Tim Brewer to ESPN Tech Center show us what's going on with that rev chip.
Andy, we've got it right here. This is a module that he's talking about, folks. You simply insert it right here. But like Andy says, the reason the cars pick up a lot of RPMs, when somebody drives up under the back of the car, what it does, it takes the air off the back of the car, puts it on their car, takes pressure off the rear spoiler and the rear wing. That makes the car accelerate, turn RPMs, makes that engine really turn up fast, Andy.
If you're going to take advantage of those big runs, you have to have an engine that'll go ahead and rev on up there. So you don't want the rev limiter to hold it back, although you don't want to over-rev the engine because it will do some damage. But I don't think they're too worried about that. And when it comes right down to it, they'll pull that chip out of there or switch boxes.
One of the big concerns we're talking about a moment ago was the tire issues. Watch the 44 car of David Ruderman. Right rear tire, and here's Brian Vickers. The right front comes apart. Twelve laps later, the 33 car of Mike Wallace has his troubles. There's so little tolerance there with the fender wells. And Andy, I mean, I guess these cars are also, you see them bobbing and bouncing out there. It doesn't take much.
No, it doesn't. And if you get just a little bit of damage to one of those sidewalls, they start losing just a little bit of air. And then they don't like to run low on air. You don't notice it really in lap times, but the tire will end up failing if it gets low on air.
Yeah, and we've had plenty of opportunities for a lot of debris out there. So it's not just running into each other, but things just on the racetrack. And we've had a couple of cautions for debris, but they obviously are having a hard time keeping it totally cleaned up.
And we have asked a couple of Goodyear folks down there to comment, and they said they're still evaluating. When they learn something, they'll let us know. They're still evaluating the situation that happened with these tires thus far. They are on top of what's going on, and they will try to update us as soon as they can. Now, Kyle Busch has led a total of 4 laps in the 3 Chase races to date. He led 1,600 in the first 26 races of the year, and he has now led 5 laps here thus far today. Lap 87, as we are just 7 laps away from the halfway point.
We heard the Goodyear guys saying they didn't really know yet what the problem was. They're going to investigate it. It's nothing really, not a consistent theme. It's not like they're all right rears or all right fronts. You know, it's really hard to tell exactly what's going on. I'm sure they're down there scrambling trying to see if there's a real issue or whether these guys are just racing so close, you know, if they're cutting each other's tire.
But it is something happening that we haven't seen here in the past. I mean, starting with practice on Friday and now going through the race today.
Usually if you have a tire problem, a real issue with the tires, it's after a certain amount of laps, and some of these have happened real quick.
Jeff Gordon back on the racetrack, an entirely new front end on his Chevy. Field will come flashing by. And Jeff right now being shown 33 laps down as he is being shown in 41st position. But with all those cars that were damaged a moment ago, he could move up pretty quickly.
It's going to be hard for him to actually maintain a minimum speed, even though they did a nice repair. I just looked at that right there. It looked great. But if he's going to run by himself, he's got to have a car that's basically clean and free of damage to be able to run that minimum speed.
From the outside line trying to come back there. Bobby Labonte, who'd got a nice push up to the front by Denny Hamlin. Then Denny jumped in behind Dale Jr. Now Jr.'s locked onto the bumper of Bobby Labonte, trying to push him towards the front.
He's going
to
get there, looks like.
Bobby Labonte has yet to lead today. That could change here momentarily if he gets a little more help than that 88 behind him.
I tell you what, there's two guys, if I'm wanting to go to the front, that I'd like to have pushing me. One of them's Dale Jr. and the other one's right behind him, Denny Hamlin. His car here the last couple of races has really been able to push guys to the front of this pack. We can see Jr. just locked on to Bobby Labonte right now. It seems that you can get two cars doing this, but it's hard unless everybody's just jammed up to get that third car. If you could get a third car involved, we can see now Junior's taking him to the front.
Now he will get him there, turn him loose, and see it's my turn to get
the middle. As far as you go.
Yep, yep.
I'll take it from here.
And that's exactly what his dad used to do, too. Same thing, same move exactly. He'd push you up there, then he'd hang you out. Dave, what's Bobby Labonte say is going on with his car?
Well, a good balance, so they didn't change any tires that time versus putting two on. So no tire change, fuel only on the 43. And crew chief Jeff Mendering told me this morning, as long as it doesn't get too dicey up front, we'll run up front if we can. And that's what he's been doing all day.
Dicey here. By the way, the 21 car, John Wood, now coming out of the garage area. He rejoins the fray. We'll try to update you on these cars that have been damaged and are getting back in. Up front, two lines. Last car, where is cousin Carl? There he is, trying to ride in the non-danger zone, maybe.
He's doing exactly what he wants. This seems to be their game plan today, that this is what they're going to do. And you adopt that plan, you've got to stick with it. There's still a long, long way to go in this race. And so he's going to have to stick with that as we see Junior back to the front.
You don't even have to look to know he's leading. You just hear this mass of humanity get on their feet and start screaming when he gets there.
But they got a little excited a little too early because Denny Hamlin actually led the lap. It looked like Junior was going to be there.
Okay, Dale, we've seen a lot of moves here. A lot of guys lead this race. What is it? What does it look like to you? Where do you need to make this move when it does come down to it? It doesn't look like you want to be in the lead when you take the white flag.
No, you don't want to be there. And I think you're going to have to wait till you get to the tri-oval here to make the move. That's what we've seen a number of times, guys, as we see Montoya go to the high side trying to take the lead. Mike?
One guy who definitely wants to be in the lead is Denny Hamlin. That's where his car is best. He said earlier in the race he can push some guys, but when he gets up underneath their rear bumper, he gets real hot and has to back off. Another problem he's dealing with, he's low on voltage. Only 13 volts underneath the hood of the 11 car right now, guys.
Oh, check out this move, guys. Oh. Mike, we were listening to you, but there was something happening here that, man, what a move.
Earnhardt Jr. was headed to Birmingham. He and the 8 car are just nailed together at the bumper and the splitter.
Well, now we see two cars that work pretty well together. Those cars just shot to the front.
Watch this again. This is worth watching again.
Watch it. He's getting a push. Now we're riding along with Dale Jr. You can see him coming up. He's pushing. Just goes to the outside of Montoya.
This looks like an afterburner right here.
Looks like he's going 20 miles an hour faster right there. Watch this.
Oh, man, they're up there in the dust and the debris.
You see Jimmy Johnson back here. It looked like he slowed down. Yeah, he thought they were going to crash.
It was a crash. It just didn't happen.
Look at Tony Urie. He was watching this as they came right by where the guys on the pit box could see it.
That's right. Baby. That's my man right there.
That's my cousin Dale Jr. He gets it done at Talladega. Yeah, 11 car back up front. Denny Hamlin will be halfway this time by. 94 laps of 188. Folks, we've only had 40 lead changes among 24 drivers. Stay tuned. It's going to get even better.
Just crossed the halfway point of today's Amp Energy 500 at Talladega, and we have got some kind of race going on. 42 lead changes, 24 different drivers. Matt Kenseth in the 17 coming up to challenge Denny Hamlin, who just took the lead back away from Matt Kenseth. Holy cow, what a race.
Oh, I tell you what, if you're in the front, you just can't seem to hold on to the front. But guys, one thing I'm noticing is the Gibbs cars, all three of them are back in action. They've had problems for so long, Brad. Yeah. Now they're looking great today.
Well, they have hooked up, especially Denny Hamlin and Kyle Busch for a little bit there. But I'm also keeping an eye on David Ragan. He has run a good race today, a smart race. Got spun on pit road. He's made his way back, had a little trouble, but he keeps fighting. I think he's going to be around at the end of the day.
I'll tell you, it's been a long time since we've seen a race that goes like this, though. Normally, there's 5-6 cars that stay up front all day long. Everybody's going back to front. I've not ever seen things change. This is, we are on pace to set a record for lead changes.
It's just amazing. Now, normally when we do these up to speeds, we kind of go back, you know, in order of the cars as they go back through the top 10. this may change as we try and pull this off.
So I say, how are you going to do that?
But we want to get you some pit reports on some of these front runners with our Ford up to speed. Denny Hamlin's leading for the moment, Mike. Go ahead.
Wish us luck, by the way, as we do this. We know the leader is Denny Hamlin. We mentioned his biggest concern right now is a voltage problem, down to 13 volts on that car. They already have a plan. Their biggest concern is on pit stops. They're worried that he might stall the car on pit road. They have a plan in place in case that happens, but that is obviously a concern for Hamlin, Shannon.
Kyle Busch in that 18 running right behind his teammate in the 11. He told his spotter to try to get in touch with Denny Hamlin's spotter to tell him not to get too far ahead, said we need to stay hooked up in this race. Right now, Kyle Busch, the only advice or the only feedback he's given about that car is that the balance is good. He's happy with that 18. Of course, looking to get back on track, and what a win would do for that 18 team. Jamie.
And what a win it would be for Matt Kenseth, the 17 on the outside, was looking for the lead, and he backed off now, sliding back just a little bit to hook up with his teammate who's behind him. Matt Kenseth, though, came in. His temperatures were up to 290. Hasn't said anything since they took some of the tape off. He's been racy all day. And Tony Stewart, remember, just not too long ago, he stayed out and he led a few laps, and he said, hey, guys, thank Jimmy Johnson for letting me take the lead. I needed to get those 5 extra bonus points. Looking for a win here, his first at Talladega, never won here before for Tony Stewart. Been pretty racy, top 10 for a while. We have trouble. Guys.
Yellow's out. Yellow, yellow, yellow.
Denny Hamlin in the wall, the leader. Another problem now.
You okay, Denny?
And he hit it a ton up there.
That thing just took a dead right-hand turn up there in 1 and 2.
Yeah, it's time to look at this situation now.
6 caution flag today and leading the race. Let's watch again what happened. Watch the right front.
Oh, that is a hard impact. Thank goodness for the safer barriers there and all of the things that NASCAR has implemented inside, including the Hans device
here,
in there.
Catch your breath.
That was a hard lick. Definitely got some kind of issue right here with these tires.
Yes, we do.
All the way from the bottom of the racetrack, from that yellow line all the way up into the safer barrier. Watch Tony Stewart getting by right in front of the 18 car.
Watch how fast this car goes up there to the outside wall.
Half back and outside. Keep coming. Yellow's out. Yellow.
Now, Elliott Sadler was in the high lane.
Stay low. You all right? All clear. Another tire deal, man. Damn, that's crazy.
That's Elliott's spotter, Brett Griffin, talking about another tire problem. You see him tending to Denny Hamlin there. Takes you a little bit. You heard him say, catch your breath. It at least takes your breath for a couple of minutes. And you just want to kind of regain your thoughts.
And DJ, he was not in the middle or one of the upper grooves. He was all the way down on the bottom of the racetrack, as close to that yellow line as you can get. So he went across 3.5 lanes on the racetrack before he impacted the wall.
Yeah, and that's as hard an impact as what you can have just by yourself like that. Go up from the bottom to the top. There's nothing you can do. You can't slow it down. You're talking 180 mile per hour impact, and just incredible. And again, hopefully Denny is okay. We see them attending to him here.
At mid corner speed is about 180 miles an hour plus, and that tire blew out.
In that amount of time, you're not talking about 5-10 miles an hour at the most, slowing down.
See, they were talking to Denny, and now he's able to step out of the car. They're going to assist him over to a stretcher.
Yes, at this point, you feel like everything in your body hurts. You're just really not sure exactly what's going on. You see Denny kind of rubbing his head.
They'll attend to him, and the drivers are going to head to pit road and make a pit stop under this 6th yellow flag of the day. Jamie.
And Matt Kenseth, you see him pull off, and Tony Stewart, the 2 yellow cars. Tony Stewart there in the middle, and Matt Kenseth on top. Remember, they just came in not too long ago and took right sides on that 17 car. You see him putting left sides on this time. Car's been racy up front, and Tony Stewart, 4 tires as well. Shannon?
And Jamie, it's 4 tires for the 18 car right now as well. Just want to make sure that if it was anything that Denny Hamlin ran over, that they're just on the safe side with 4 tires. Dave?
And Shannon, the 88 car of Dale Earnhardt Jr., they will take on four tires as well. Angled into the box here, he'll be fine getting out. No one ahead of him right now. In he leaves pit road.
Very deliberately exiting pit road. Everyone coming in to take a look at all four tires. And understandably, Travis Quapel, who was the pole sitter, gaining 11 positions there on that exchange. Scott Riggs, we haven't mentioned much about Riggs having a very good run in the 66 car.
Yeah, he's doing an excellent job so far. He's had his car right up in that lead pack most of the day.
Again, this sixth caution flag of the day, the leader, Denny Hamlin, right front tire. Big explosion, the car going up across the racetrack into the outside concrete, and now he has been assisted from the car.
So as we've just gone through the midway point of today's race here in Talladega, we have a tire situation on our hands, obviously. Rusty Wallace, Brad Daugherty, and Ray Evernham. Ray, your crew chief, you're sitting down there on the pit box. You're watching this happen. What are you thinking? What are you doing?
Well, you got somebody from Goodyear by the shirt right now. First of all, I mean, honestly, you know, too many races this year have been decided on tires. So they're checking codes, they're checking pressures, they're trying to find out what's going on. One, two, three of them, you say cuts. You know, we're starting to have some problems. And thank God that NASCAR brought in softballs.
Yeah. And another thing going on right now, as a driver out there, if you're having this problem, you need to be talking to your driver, saying if there's anything you can do inside of that car to minimize this in any set particular way, you better get after it. I mean, if the car is too tight, you're sliding the front end, try to minimize it. If the car's running real loose, guys, try to minimize that. They're trying to take care of the right front, take care of the right rear, because that's where the problems are right now. It's just not one corner. We've seen it in the front and the back.
That's what I was going to say, Rusty. We're seeing guys, Brian Vickers' race car was on the straight going down through, and the right front tire just lets go. It's going to start, it looks like it's happening at any place on the racetrack. So in the mind of the driver, there's got to be that little seed planted now. Does that create a little bit of doubt?
It could be. And Ray, one question I do have for you with these bump stops, these guys running the very front, the car's running so low. Could it be working the inside edge of the tires and hurting the tires that way?
It could be, but it doesn't look like that, Rusty. It looks like there's something going on from the centrifugal force or the speed for extended periods of time that's making the tire have a problem. And again, that's only my speculation.
Yeah, we again have asked Goodyear for someone to come on camera and comment. They have told us they're still researching it, and when they have something to say, they will come and talk with us. Meanwhile, let's talk with some crew chiefs about what they're seeing. Shannon?
Alan, we're down here with Gil Martin, crew chief for Clint Bowyer. Gil, obviously there's some issue with the tires going on. We really don't know what it is yet, but are there any precautions that you guys can take to prevent it from happening to this team?
Well, what we're doing right now is we're checking with some of the other teams and our teams, obviously, on pit road. But the 33 blew a tire earlier. We're checking the codes, serial codes on the tires. Anything we've got around that, we're trying to get rid of. But I think a lot of it's got to do with guys running a little bit higher air pressure on the right side, a little higher than recommended. And with that happening right there, the car's got a little early speed in it, but it also is very abusive on the tire, especially if you've got a lot of camber in the right front. So we've kept our air pressure on the conservative side, and haven't seen any problems yet, so knock on wood, we won't have any.
Yeah, and Clint Bowyer currently running seventh.
A lot of theories still, just that though, a lot of theories about the unfolding tire situation here at Talladega in the middle point of this race. Ask your AT&T Crew Chief Challenge question earlier, which chaser will get their first restrictor plate win today at Talladega? Obviously, if you voted for Denny Hamlin, it is not going to be him. He was just involved in a heavy crash. A lot of you think it will be Matt Kenseth. And not a bad pick. Matt has had a very strong run today. Back with more after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
We are at lap 103 of the AMP Energy 500 at Talladega as they come down to the green flag again and restart. Scott Riggs in the 66 car being showing the way. Riggs, a lot of speculation this weekend. He told me with a big smile on his face yesterday he had a contract in hand to sign this week, which would settle his plans for 2009, but he'd like to win one first. And he will lose the lead just that quickly coming off the corner to Paul Menard.
Yeah, he got a little too far out front there, and these guys kind of teamed up behind him and left him sitting.
Yeah, these DEI cars have been very strong today, too. See, Almirola, he's pushed quite a few guys. We saw him push Dale Jr. right to the lead just like this.
Yeah.
44 car, David Rudiman had a tire issue early in the day back on lap 53, and he has gotten back on the racetrack and they're running pretty well.
Yeah, it doesn't look too good. not part of the UPS decals off of there on the right side, but we still know who that is and running well.
And he's ninth.
Yeah.
Have a tire come apart, and then come back and run in the top 10 with Elliott Sadler right on his deck.
We'll let you know that Ken Schrader got the free pass once again. That was his second straight, and he's actually back on the lead lap now.
Yeah, he was two laps down at one point. So with all this action we've had, he's gotten a couple of them back. Paul Menard, he's out here out front. You know, he won his very first race that he ran here at this track. He drove for me in an ARCA race, and he'd never seen the place. Came here and won the race. He knows how to get it done here.
Big news of the week is that he will move in 2009 to Yates Racing. His dad, the sponsorship, Menard's going to run Fords, possibly a third Ford for them in 2009. Juan Pablo Montoya's Dodge getting a little push from Junior in the Chevy.
Dale Junior, he looks out there for the fastest car that he can find and run with, and he's usually pretty good about picking one out. This 42 is fast today.
Yeah, there's more than just having a fast car. You got to know what to do with it and how to work your way back to the front. You know, these guys took on four tires. You know, they're not playing this game of maybe two. They're not taking any chances. They got them back in the pack, but they know they have a fast enough car if they can get hooked up together, move back to the front. Dave?
And Dale, you know what? This is one of the things that Dale Jr. does up there when he runs up at the front. He learns. He learns what's going on with a 42 car, who he can draft with, as we see a pass for the lead again, who he can draft around, who might be his friend at the end of the race. And that's one of the things that Jr.'s been doing all day long. Even a guy who runs so well here, still taking on the data.
Well, you have to be willing to learn throughout this race. You can't come in here thinking that even though you've done well and everybody talks about Dale Jr. being the man, you have to be ready to accept what's going to be happening in this race and whose car may be better. You see the two of them going to the high side here again.
Got to get Harvick there, Jimmy Johnson up there, Biffle up there. Now there's five of them to be able to take on the other lines.
I'm sure somebody's going to jump up here in front of Montoya here in just a second. Well, that'd be his teammate, slows his progress down some.
Reed Sorensen, the 41, the 07th car there, by the way, that is the only car, Clint Bowyer. He's the only chaser who has not led a lap today.
If he can hang on right there, those guys will push him to the front.
Yeah, I was going to say, hang on a lap or two here, Will.
That could change.
It'll be his turn here before long.
Yeah, this is equal opportunity day here for sure.
Denny Hamlin, we are being told, is alert and awake, but will be transported to an area hospital for further evaluation. Good news that he was alert and awake after that hard impact into the safer barrier there just a little bit ago.
Yeah, here's two drivers right here, Dale Jr. and Montoya. I think we're going to see teaming up some more before the end of this race. I think both of them know that, you know, they have fast race cars, and they both know how to, even though Montoya hasn't won here, he finished second in the first race.
And back in April, I started to say, DJ, it was Montoya who actually pushed Kyle Busch through a bunch of traffic late, and Montoya impressed a lot of people starting back in 26 to run in the top five most of the day and finish second.
Every restrictor plate race has its own personality,
yeah.
And there's different guys that you can work with sometimes. Maybe the last race you worked with a certain driver or car, it doesn't work this race. They're all different, and they're spending all this part of the race right now trying to find the guy that they can work the best with and what situation they want to be in when it comes down to that last 10 laps.
Yeah, well, what's happened now is we've got a much smaller group of cars. So, you know, instead when we had literally 43 cars all piled together, as we see them still battling hard, but they've only got about 28 cars here on the lead lap that they're having to deal with. So it makes it a lot easier, and you can find that guy. We see Matt Kenseth right here giving a nudge.
Keep talking about these cars running hot. They don't run far enough apart from each other to get any air in the front. You see these guys just right against each other, and they're three, four wide at times.
Kenseth in the middle of there is Biffle in the back. Shannon.
Doc, the back is where Greg Biffle has been this entire race. He has been hanging out back there. I spoke with his crew chief, Greg Irwin, and you want to keep this in mind. In practice on Friday, Greg Biffle made four drafting runs, and in three of those four drafting runs, he was able to move from the back to the front. Greg Irwin told me, we're going to let the race dictate where we run today, but they have been hanging out in the back, but don't expect them to be there for long.
Remember, Biffle has raced here 11 times, has never had a top five or a top 10 finish.
Well, if he's literally going to use that, you see Bobby Labonte going up through the middle. He has a fast race car. But if Biffle's truly going to use that strategy, you have to really show patience and use it all day. You know, 78 laps to go doesn't mean it's time to go. You've got plenty of time left here. And so he's going to still have to continue to be patient. He can get his way to the front.
How long can you wait? I mean, really, realistically, when can you? How long can you wait to make that move?
Could you, honestly, with a good race car, with this group of cars right here, you could wait till lap 180. Eight laps, you could make your way to the front easily. And if you go too early, we heard Jeff Gordon say that in right before the race started. He made his way up there too early and got shuffled back. You want to be going forward when we get down here. We see Tony Stewart headed to the front with the push of Montoya.
Tony Stewart had led two laps today. Now make it three as he gets the push by from Montoya. Remember, Tony led the most laps here in the April race.
We've had 50 lead changes and 111 laps.
Unbelievable.
This is just fantastic.
We have now tied the all-time record for different leaders at 26, set here back in 1986 and again in 2001. 26 of the 43 starters have led this race today.
So far, we've still got time for the other guys.
And no power being called on David Rudiman, who was running in the top 10.
After all that, worked his way back in the top 10, now he's got a problem.
76, hold your breath, laps to go at Talladega. It's going to get even better, folks. Don't go away. You're watching ESPN on ABC. The shuffle continues at Talladega. 31 car coming up toward the front. Tonight, a season to celebrate everyday heroes continues as an 8-year-old cheerleader inspires one unforgettable makeover. An all-new Extreme Makeover Home Edition tonight, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 7 Central on ABC.
There's some of these cars going to need a makeover themselves before this is over, but Jeff Burton got a pretty strong car. He was pushing Matt Kenseth just a couple of laps ago, and then Matt got in behind Jeff and trying to get him to the lead.
Jeff Burton, known for patience on the super speedways. When I talked to him and Richard Childress yesterday in the garage area, he was very excited, almost giddy, trying to say, I got a great race car, but I got to know when to use it.
Man, Tony just got a big shot from Montoya right there.
There were 52 lead changes here in April and 188 laps. We've had 51 lead changes and 115 laps so far. Look at that.
Tony's acting like he wants it for keeps, though. I don't think that's going to happen, but he's got a couple of good cars right behind him. You see Menard right on the bumper of Montoya there pushing him.
He's held it longer than most of these guys have been able to hold that lead. Let's look at Carl Edwards. He's still hanging out at the back. Dale, just like you said, being very patient.
Well, you have to do it. If you're gonna go with that strategy, you have to make it work the whole time. Doesn't mean just because we've had a couple of big accidents and taking some of these cars out and had some engine problems, take some others out, that it's time to go yet. Anything could still happen. So Carl's sticking to his plan.
His team was saying they were all talking this week about the fact when he went back and looked at the October races, the last three races in October had been won by a last lap pass. In fact, the last Ford to win it here was 2005 and won Dale Jarrett. Made a last lap pass on Tony Stewart and Matt Kenseth. So Carl Edwards sort of doing the Dale Jarrett philosophy here.
You made that move fairly late too. I mean, you hung out back there till it was about 8 or 10 laps to go, wasn't it?
Like I said, you got to be going forward at the end. I mean, I was very fortunate in that happening, but I always wanted, when I had to employ that type of strategy, you just have to be patient enough to wait. I've made other times to where I made that move too early, and whenever we got down to the closing laps, I was going the wrong direction and ended up with a finish outside the top 10. Jeff Burton back to, he's up to the lead.
If he can make it to start finish line, it'll be another lead change.
That's right. See, Dale Jr. back in this. He was back in about 12th just a minute ago.
This outside line got a big surge here this last lap. I think a lot of these guys are probably going to migrate towards that upper lane after seeing Denny Hamlin blow that tire right on the bottom of the racetrack. The safer place to be would be as close to the wall as you could be if there was a tire problem.
I think that, and typically here you see that this groove starts moving up. I don't know exactly why. It's just somebody sees it happening and makes it work, and that outside line takes over and becomes a better line. What do you think, Rusty?
Tell you what, man, this groove they got going on the top side of the racetrack is something you can just, like we've been talking about all day long, you're leading one lap, and the next time you're not leading it, I don't think you can hold on this lead at all. I mean, you got to drive so defensive to do that. But Dale, I'll tell you another thing I'm concerned about right now. We're coming up on a couple laps when we've been starting to have these tire problems. So I hope it doesn't occur again, but Alan Bestock was telling us just a little while ago off camera that it's about time when this problem gets ready to happen.
Yeah, hopefully we can get through this stretch, and those all were just things that were related to guys rubbing each other and debris on the racetrack. And I think that if you can get this high line going and these guys stay together like that, I think it's more difficult for the bottom to come back in. They see David Reagan's the one down on the bottom trying to lead that charge back to the front. Now, he's had a strong car all day, but this seems to be the time of the race when that high side takes over and is better. As we see Kevin Harvick jump down there trying to get to the front.
Carl Edwards maybe started to get a little racy last time by. He is his clocking, actually, he had dropped back and he just jumped in the throttle, I guess, and his lap was quicker than what the leaders were running. So maybe just sort of seeing what he's got.
Well, you'll see that happen with these, you know, all these cars getting two and three wide ahead of him. He'll back off a little bit and then he'll run in that vacuum and just run right back up to him, and you'll see that fast lap time.
Three lines again, three wide. This is where they get in trouble.
Yeah, it's nice they calmed down after the big accident.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was 53 lead changes that lap.
Yeah, Jeff Burton was a leader about half a mile ago. Now he's about 11th.
Man, look at the front end of this car, David Reagan. He has worn that bumper out.
Yeah, and that's from bump drafting.
That's not
here.
A wreck. That's no. Just pushing these guys.
David Reagan has one stout race car after starting at the back of the pack from an engine change. He got to the front in 15 laps from the back of the field and led early in this race, and he has been hanging there. In the top 10 right now, he is second behind Kevin Harvick. It is Harvick, Reagan, Stewart, Menard, and Almirola in the top five.
Kevin Harvick, the leader here in the Amp Energy 500 at Talladega, looking down on this massive 2 2/3 mile track as these cars zoom around from Goodyear. Our aerial coverage brought to you by Goodyear. Get there on Silent Armor technology with the strength of Kevlar for toughness and a comfortable ride. What a day here at Talladega so far. 26 of the 43 starters have led, 53 lead changes, and we're just past 300 miles of this 500-mile event. Kevin Harvick, one of the championship chasers, is up front. In fact, most of the championship chasers have fared well today, though Jeff Gordon has spent time in the garage after getting caught up in a crash, and Denny Hamlin is being transported to a local hospital after he had a hard crash while leading this race just a short time ago. On the lead lap, 27 of the 43 starters. Every one of the championship chasers except Clint Bowyer has led this race. And the main theme on today, well, two main themes on today. One, nobody can hold the lead. The driver that's led the most laps in this race so far has only led 14 laps. And the other theme has been some of the tire issues that we have seen pop up here that have brought out the caution a few times and cost some drivers some torn up race cars. What a race so far.
Well, so far the race has been totally unpredictable. Nobody can predict who can hold the lead. We don't know who the strongest car is right now. The DEI cars have looked real good. You know, you look at Chip Ganassi's cars. Juan Pablo Montoya's been up front. He's been in the back. It's just hard to see who's the strongest.
You're absolutely right, Rusty. But the two guys that keep popping into my eye as I watch the screen, I watch our monitor, is David Reagan, who's running second right now, and Eric Almirola. He has had an outstanding day. He has kept that race car up around that top 10 all day long. These two young drivers are having outstanding days.
Can't count out Travis Quappel, that white, blue, orange decal, 28 car, started on the pole. The Yates team
job.
Having a strong day.
Or Paul Menard. You know, this race in history, you know, Phil Parsons, Bobby Hill, and Ron Bouchard, names like that, surprise winners. Hey, you could have one of those guys win their first cup race here today.
Nine different drivers scored their first win here at Talladega. Seven of those drivers, it was their only Cup Series win. We'll see if we get a first-time winner today. By the way, I mentioned the leader of the most laps today has only led 14 laps. That's Dale Earnhardt Jr., and he's back in 18th right now. Doc, keeping an eye on some of these championship guys that are riding around in the back as well. Carl Edwards kind of hanging out at the tail end of this lead draft back in 25th. Hard to figure out how this is going to play out, isn't it?
What a wild scramble, Alan. And by the way, this is the longest green flag run we have had since the first 34 laps of the race. We went back to green at lap 105. And now we're at lap 127. So now everyone watching and wondering what could happen with some of these tires. Let's go down and check in with Dave.
With Tony Gibson, he is a crew chief for Eric Almirola in that eight car. Do you think with some of the moves he's made, Tony, which has been impressive and the car has run well, that guys have seen enough to work with him at the end of this race?
Yeah. You know, he's still a rookie. He's only got like two restricted play races, but you know, he learned a lot here in the spring. He ran really good behind the 24. We had a flat, but you know, he's doing a phenomenal job. He's being smart. Everybody at Dell Earnhardt Incorporated should be proud of themselves. We built brand new race cars to come here. ECR with awesome motors, and Eric's doing a tremendous job. So he's learning a lot, but you know, when it comes down about two to go, you're gonna find out how much he's learned. He learned a lot behind the 88, so hopefully maybe Dale Jr. will get back up there, and I think we got a friend in him.
Running well today, Doc.
He mentioned ECR engines. That's the Earnhardt Childress Engine Cooperative, and they got three cars in the top seven, including the leader, Kevin Harvick. There's Almirola in the 8 car, the 07 there, Clint Bowyer. 31 also moving up. That's Jeff Burton. So they got four cars in the top 10.
One thing I worry about, we got 60 laps to go, and I don't know if the front bumper on that 8 car is going to make it that far. That thing is just about worn out.
Yeah, Highside's trying to come back. Travis Quaffle back up there, getting a push from Clint Bowyer. So they're trying to make that work. As you see, the bottom lane's got spread out just a little bit.
When Travis Quappel won the pole here on Friday, he got a little bit emotional in the media center. Said, when I was growing up, I watched Davey Allison drive that 28 car here at Talladega. He said, when I got here and I think about the Alabama gang and Davey Allison's memory, I get misty thinking about what it would mean to take this car back to victory lane. Mike.
And this team's confidence was extremely high coming into this race. I spoke with Quappel in pre-race introductions, and he said they've made significant gains, but the one area that they've really gained the most is something that no engineer can provide. That's respect. Travis felt like, now that he's run with this series for the entire year, he feels like maybe more people will run with him. He's also got another ace up his sleeve, and that, of course, is Todd Parrott. Now, DJ, I know you know Todd pretty well. How much emphasis does he place on this type of racing?
This is what Todd Parrott loves right here, this type. I know, you know, we had that time between the end of the previous season and getting to the Daytona 500. That's all Todd Parrott thought about, was getting to the Daytona 500. And when we left the Daytona 500, it was getting ready for Talladega. He puts a lot of emphasis on this and making his cars the very best that he possibly can. And when you get behind the wheel of that, you know that you're going to have a car capable of winning. And I tell you what, he talks about that respect. That'll also help him in people knowing that Todd Parrott has helped him get this race car here. So that's going to help Travis in this situation because they know it's a fast car.
This is Travis Quappel's 100th career start in the NASCAR Sprint Cup, and how memorable could it be if he could pull it off today? Let's check in on Kevin Harvick, our leader. Jamie?
And it could be memorable for him, too. Still looking for his first win since the 2007 Daytona 500. Kevin Harvick's whole plan this entire day was to run up front. Todd Barrier, his crew chief, told me every time we try to stay back and stay in that backpack, we get wrecked. We are going to the front. Even though they started 39th, they've been running up front. Most of the time, the team tells me they are planning on pitting around lap 135. Kevin Harvick has had a vibration all day. See if they can make that a little better on this next stop, Doc.
Let's check in. We've been talking about, Jamie, the tire issues and the concerns, and we have a Goodyear individual down with Dave Burns.
That's right. It's Rick Heinrich. He is the product manager for Goodyear. We've seen a lot of failures, Doc, but we don't have a lot of answers yet. Rick, your team has been looking at what's been going on today. What have you discovered so far?
Our engineers are still looking at all the tires, sort of reviewing all the details. What we do know, this is the same exact combination of tires that we ran in the spring. We had a very good race on them. It's a race-proven combination of tires. One of the tires we looked at had 100% evidence of a puncture. When a tire goes flat on the racetrack, it's very destructive. And a lot of times what you need to look at is either still out there on the racetrack or it's just destroyed. Some of the analysis that we're going to have to do back in Akron, Ohio. We're going to be collecting everything and sending it back for further analysis to try and find out for sure exactly what's happened. There's a tremendous amount of car contact out there, and that loosens things up and drops things on the track. There's been some accidents, so can't say for sure in every case what's happened. We're still continuing to look at it.
Have you asked the teams about their tire pressure today, and are you concerned at all about high tire pressures? And I also want to ask about ambient conditions. Is it a lot warmer than it was in the spring?
Not really. Don't feel that the ambient temperature really has anything to do with it. We don't see any signs of heat on the tires. As far as air pressures, the teams that we've talked to haven't found anything unusual there at all.
Okay, guys, that's what they know for right now. And as Rick mentioned, more analysis when they send these damaged tires back to the main shop in Akron.
All right, Dave, thank you. They will now have run 30 laps since they've gone back to green flag racing, and the longest they had run today was 34 laps early on here at the drop of the green.
Rick Heinrich brings up a good point. There is a lot of contact out there, not just side to side like we normally see that would cause a tire problem, but these front to rear bump drafts. We've seen more bump drafts in this race than I've ever seen it at Talladega. And some of that, you see the fiberglass is flapping on a lot of these cars. Those little pieces of fiberglass can actually cut a tire too if they're falling off on the racetrack and these guys are catching a piece of that. So that could be a little bit of one of the issues that's going on, because there's no theme. We've run a lot of laps now and no problems. Other times we've seen problems in like 10 laps.
Dave? Yeah, guys, let me throw this one in there too, because Casey Mears was speculating with his crew about the possibility of the tolerances being so close with these cars that possibly when they hit each other, whether you're the guy in front or the guy behind, that there's some movement there, and there may actually be some parts of the car with the tolerances so close that are hitting the tires and then, of course, backing right back off. So there's another speculation from one of the drivers.
53 laps to go. Pit stops coming up. Kevin Harvick now has led the most consecutive laps of anyone today. He's led the last 15 laps. Back after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Kevin Harvick continuing to lead the AMP Energy 500 at Talladega, and we are under caution once again. Smoke billowing out of the 24 car, Jeff Gordon's pipes, and he had just taken the left-hand turn to go to the garage area. They saw suddenly smoke billow out. I didn't want to take a chance on having something coming out fluid-wise on the racetrack. There is Gordon, who had been in the garage area after that accident earlier in the day. On lap 53, they had to replace the front end, and there is the smoke now billowing out of his Chevy.
Yeah, you can't take a chance there. There's oil coming out of that car. See this right here from Michael Waltrip's car and our camera lens. Definitely fluid. That was a good move, NASCAR putting this caution out.
Yeah.
We've already had enough cars torn up. We don't need any more.
And that probably came from that earlier accident whenever the radiator was busted and he drove it back in.
Probably has run the car hot or damaged the engine somehow. They made a lot of laps and probably made up some spots by getting him out there, but he won't make any more.
Terry Labonte will get the free pass. He was being shown three laps down in 28th position. There are 27 cars on the lead lap, and now crew chief 49 laps to go. They're going to have to pit in about four laps anyway.
It's going to be close. Oh. Yeah, a lot of these guys can't go quite that far, so it's going to be interesting here.
Break out the calculator batteries on pit road. This is going to involve maybe a stop and maybe a top off, huh?
Yeah, it could. I mean, you'll see some guys coming in here maybe trying to make it to the end and top it off on the one to go. And some of them may not be able to make it from here.
Here they come. Let's going to see probably, I'm guessing, four tires. They got to get it as full as they can, so you might as well put all you can put on while you're sitting there.
Yeah, this would be the time to get four tires for sure,
yeah,
in case
absolutely.
You would have to come back another time.
Especially with the problems we've seen, four tires is what you want right here. Jamie?
And your leader, Kevin Harvick, been enjoying the view. He said, gosh, I was hoping NASCAR was going to see that there was a bunch of something, whether it was water or fluid, whatever, sometime. He saw it, and thank goodness for him. Four tires for Kevin Harvick, no adjustments on that 29. Shannon?
Me, David Reagan, four tires, no changes. They said, pack this little fuel, give me long gears, trying to save fuel.
And guys, eight cars on pit road, four tire change. Can Eric Alvarola win his first NASCAR Sprint Cup race? He'll have four fresh tires to do it. No chassis adjustments on that race car. Mike?
Todd Parrott originally calling for a two tire change on the 28 car. They changed that at the last minute. Went for four tires and fuel, no adjustments on Travis Quapel's machine.
Carl Edwards spins it around exiting pit road and does a 360, Joey Chipman style.
How about that?
He had avoided coming in traffic most of the day to try to keep from being hit by anybody, and almost has an accident himself as he's trying to leave there.
He only had one car that he beat out. I don't know what
now
his hurry
see,
was, really.
Now I see why he was trying to pit by himself.
Yeah, it was him he was worried about.
Boy, pit stops have been an adventure for Carl Edwards the last couple of weeks. Working caution for the seventh time today. This caution coming out with fluids coming out of the 24 car of Jeff Gordon, who has now gone to the garage area.
Andy, you bring him back in to put tires on it after that?
Yeah, probably. I mean, if I'm the crew chief, yes. If I'm the car owner, probably not. You hate to throw a set of tires away, but probably would.
Double zero, Kenny Wallace being shown as a leader, one of the Michael Waltrip racing cars. Kenny, who had been held a lap early on because he had to go, he was held in the pits a lap because of speeding on pit road, but the double zero being shown as a leader here with 48 to go. Life on Mars series premiere Thursday at 10 Eastern, 9 Central after an all-new Grey's Anatomy. Television's next great cop show has arrived. Life on Mars coming up October 9th at 10 Eastern, 9 Central. Looked like Carl may have visited Mars recently. He made a loop around the planet there with his car coming off of pit road. Now, how does this happen, DJ?
Well, he's just trying to, he's got in the gas and a little bit too hard. He's on that concrete surface there, and that's a little bit slick and just trying to be a little too aggressive there.
Clear one, only one, only one, only one.
Well, no harm done.
You know, he hasn't, seven, really, that's it.
Hasn't really raced anybody off pit road all day.
Back at the back of the pack now. Andy, strategy here. Crew chief, what do? Do you bring these guys back on pit road
and top it off? Yeah, you're going to have to if you're going to try to make it from here. If you have any chance of making it, you probably will come in here.
Let's visit with our in-race reporter, Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Junior, Dale Jarrett, do you have a copy?
Yes, sir.
Well, we're getting closer to the end of this thing. Do you have something for these guys that you can win?
Yeah, we've been up front some. We led some laps, car can make some passes. It's just, that was interesting, that little last run, how everybody got so protective at that run. We still got a long, long ways to go. 49 laps is a lot of laps here. And they got real protective there at the end. It was really, really hard to make any headway from where I was back at, you know, in the back. So it's interesting. The smaller the pack has gotten due to the wrecks and whatnot, it's gotten a bit more of a challenge to put runs together and get enough people on the outside groove and whatnot to do things you want to do. But we'll see. So I have to probably get a little dirty here in a bit. These things going to look like they race apart still, I think, once they're with them.
Have you found you a drafting partner?
Well, me and Juan have been working together. I think we got a lot of respect for each other, and you can see that in the way we've been drafting a little bit. My teammates are looking really good. I'd like to help Jimmy get up there when he's ready to go or be a part of that, because I know he's going to get up there eventually if I'm having trouble, if I'm not there yet. But it's tough, man. It's a challenge. It's really a lottery pick. It's tough. How you get up there and how long and for how long you can be there.
All right, you have fun. We're having fun watching you.
Appreciate it, man. Thank you.
He is back in 13th spot. Joe Nemechek, by the way, become the 27th different leader in all-time Cup Series record. You're watching ESPN on ABC. 45 laps to go here in the AMP Energy 500 at the world's fastest stock car facility, Talladega Super Speedway. The top eight cars did not come back on the pit road a moment ago, but everyone else did on the lead lap, came in and topped off to try to make it on fuel. Kyle Busch, David Ragan, Travis Quappel, Tony Stewart, Jimmy Johnson, the top five as we get the green waved here once again. Can those guys that came in, could come in, can they make it, Andy?
Well, they think they can. That's why they came in and got gas. So it's going to be close for a lot of these guys, especially the guys that did not come in, unless they're getting great mileage. Some of those guys up front may not be able to make it even if they did come in, so that's why they didn't come.
David Ragan running in second spot. Started at the back of the pack because of an engine change on Friday. Got to the front in 17 laps. Still looking for that very first NASCAR Sprint Cup victory. Kyle Busch hoping to turn his chase fortunes around. We talked about Talladega being a turning point. He has yet to get a top 25 finish in three chase races. That could change here in the next 44 laps.
It could or could not, depending on what happens in this. We haven't even gotten to the wild part of this race yet. Yeah, here's the other thing, too, guys. We haven't seen what some of these guys can really do. We know Carl Edwards has been hanging out at the back. Who are these other guys that have really not shown their hand that we're going to see come up here and be a player at the end of the race?
I think we've seen the hanging back part of it. I think even though if I were doing it, I would be a little more conservative than going right now, because you've gone this far. Why not take it a little bit further? But we can see Carl making his way towards the front. I think they're finished with that strategy.
Now teammates starting to hook up a little bit. That's 12th and 13th to 07 and 29. Bowyer, remember, he's the only chase driver who has yet to lead today. Harvick behind him. Upper line, you see Kenseth starting to come, and cousin Carl now starting to push his way up there instead of hanging back so much.
Get a few other guys pushing. We heard Dale Jr. tell us a while ago that they were already starting to cut each other off.
I think this 99 car is extremely strong because he ran at the back of the pack and he could at will run right back up to these guys. So he might have a real strong horse we haven't seen yet.
This is the car that Carl Leverage used to finish second in Daytona when it was brand new back in July.
They chose that outside line right there. He and Matt Kenseth, and they're kind of headed backwards as these other guys are going.
Mike, that might have been an experiment right there. Mike?
Well, guys, if you remember, basically they've had 1 year, all these teams, 1 year to develop their restrictor plate program with this new car because it debuted here 1 year ago. I spoke with Bob Osborne about that at the beginning of the day, asked him where they improved the most. He said, in the bodies. He said, believe it or not, when we were back here in October of last year, the bodies were just kind of flapping around in the wind. They just weren't stable. They've added a lot of bracing to the car and have made this car much more aerodynamic. And because of that, he feels like it's much more competitive than they were a year ago. Jamie?
And his teammate Matt Kenseth, I talked to his crew chief earlier today, Chip Bowen, and he said, you know, we haven't put a lot of emphasis on our super speedway cars at Roush Fenway. We concentrate on the tracks like mile and a half more so. He said, but we have 10 guys in our shop that are dedicated to these super speedway cars, and he had a lot of confidence in their car. The 17 Matt Kenseth have been strong all day, guys.
Thank you, Jamie. It's three wide. There's Bobby Labonte, who has a very good car in the middle of that group. Casey Mears behind him, who started on the outside of the front row. 48 car Jimmy Johnson there, and also in the front. Dave.
And he's in that outside line. That is where he said he wants to be. Now, you might be wondering about that motor and the fact that they removed that rev limiter chip earlier today. Has it been better for him as he drops to the rear right now? It has been. He said before, I had to hold the throttle down and I couldn't keep up. On these last runs, I've been able to go half throttle sometimes and stay with the pack. This is the best it's been all day long.
Kyle Busch moving back down across the racetrack to try to stay in front of Montoya. That's the way they finished here back in April. It was Montoya who pushed Kyle Busch through the traffic. Now a little pushing and shoving with the 88 and the 42.
I like the way this 88 and 42 have been working together today. They seem to have a really good combination going.
Yeah, you heard Junior talk about that they a lot of respect for each other, and they got fast race cars. So we'll see them, see if they can work their way by Kyle Busch.
Kyle Busch trying to hold on with a lot of eager, anxious people behind him. Shannon.
Well, Kyle Busch, two right sides on that last pit stop, did not come down and top off for fuel. His spotter told him that is the line that you want to be in, the 42, the 88, and the 31. But I got to ask you guys, how dangerous is Kyle Busch leading this race, possibly taking a gamble, knowing that he really has nothing to lose?
That's exactly right, Shannon. And the thing is that all of these passes that we've seen for the lead earlier today, when guys just let them kind of go by there, that's by the wayside now. It's time to protect your turf. And Kyle Busch out there, he can make that Toyota as wide as anybody here.
He won't be able to block all three lanes, though. And we've seen it get three wide when these guys get racy.
So in other words, what you're saying is no more Mr. Nice Guy.
No more Mr. Nice Guy. No, we're inside of 40 laps to go, and these guys, all the giving that they've done before, it's just going to be all take from this point forward.
RCR cars, fourth, fifth, and sixth. None of those three have won here at Talladega.
Just behind this group of cars is Carl Edwards coming on the outside. We talked about him trying to make that work. You can see him up on that high line with his teammate Greg Biffle.
They go down inside of Casey Mears and sort of hang him out on the high line. Travis Quapple actually leading that Ford charge.
They got three strong Fords right there. David Reagan, another one in there. He's right behind Bobby Labonte.
42 car, we talked about Montoya. The last, for you Dodge fans, the last time a Dodge won at Talladega, how about August 1976? Dave Marcus, 32 years ago. How special would that be if Dodge could pull it off today, and Montoya has got one strong horse?
34 laps to go. The intensity's picking up once again at Talladega. Our aerial coverage today brought to you by Goodyear. Get there on Silent Armor technology with the strength of Kevlar for toughness and a comfortable ride. Well, they rode along for quite a while before that last caution behind Kevin Harvick, since the last restart behind Kyle Busch, but now there's a new leader. It's Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Oh, boy, Dale Earnhardt Jr. got real aggressive just a little while ago with Kyle Busch, kind of beating on his bumper. Take a look at his replay coming up, guys. I mean, it was really aggressive looking. Here he goes into turn three, hitting old Clint Bowyer. Watch as Bowyer goes to the top. He gets in an 18 car just a little bit, knocks him sideways. They're all checking up behind back, guys. It is getting crazy out there right now.
I'll tell you what, Clint Bowyer did a great job of not turning that race car around. He got that little bump right there. He gets out of the way. Here comes Junior. He has got a tremendous run. He gets right into the back of Busch.
Now, Junior said he's going to have to get a little bit dirty and get pushing and shoving. It's getting time to get going, and he's definitely done that.
So we've seen a lot of racing offense today with the bump drafting and the guys trying to push their way by. We saw a lot of racing defense there from Kyle Busch a minute ago. That could have been the big wreck, and we've said it before. Well, here's another challenge for the lead. Here comes Jeff Burton, Doc.
Burton on the bottom of the racetrack. Kevin Harvick, all three of the RCR cars trying to go by. Remember, they have the same engines as the DEI cars that were so good in qualifying. These guys got back in the middle of the pack and are now moving up. Look at Junior coming back on the high side, jumping back in that Hendrick horsepower.
I saw his car bobble over in the middle of three and four, and then as he came off of four, I thought maybe he had a flat at that time, but it looks like the car's okay.
Got no help on the outside right now, though.
Nope.
Glued together. Can't get much closer than that. Jeff Burton has now led five laps today. Kevin Harvick behind him has led the most laps, 22. Clint Bowyer behind him has yet to lead today. Folks, we are commercial-free here to the end, so you may want to double up on the heart medicine because this one's going to get very interesting.
Yeah, this is, it's been great all day, but it's getting ready to get really, really good. You see those cars pass. Let's give a call to Robbie Gordon there. He's in the middle. He's the fourth car on the outside line. One point in time, he was a lap. I think he's gotten a free pass maybe twice, or actually didn't get it one time because he put fuel in too much for a second time under one of them, but up there in the middle of this fray.
Robbie Gordon, the seven car. His worst finish on a plate track this year is 11th. He finished 8th at Daytona and 6th at Daytona in July 11th here in April. Dave.
And he's one of the guys, Doc, who came down right before the green and topped off on his fuel. So even if we would happen to have overtime, an extension of this race at the end, if there's a late caution, Robbie Gordon would be good.
Well, that's one that doesn't mind getting aggressive whenever it gets time to. So Junior said it was going to get down and dirty here.
How about Michael Waltrip in that 55? He got that tire across the hood and the roof of his car, and they did a repair on it, and he's moved his way back up into the middle of this pack.
Yeah, that thing's about as bad aerodynamically as you could possibly want with everything they've had to do to it, but here he is in the middle of it.
Michael won here back in September of 2003. You know how good he's been on these plate tracks over the years.
He could be one of those guys that really hadn't shown what he's got.
Yeah. It actually lost the draft before this, the previous caution, and wasn't even part of the group. But they obviously worked on that thing a little bit more and has got him up in the middle of the pack.
Tell you what, guys, this is a long way to go, I think, to be getting this racy. DJ, we were talking earlier, you said about eight laps to go. There's enough time getting it back to the front, and I totally agree with what you're saying, but aren't these guys really getting, you know, just too wild out there right now, this far out?
Yeah, I think it was interesting when we talked to Junior there as he goes, as he's pushing David Reagan to the front here. But we heard Junior talk that last time that the guys were off, getting awful racy that soon. It was like he wasn't ready to start doing all of that stuff. So
what, he's doing it right here.
Well, he said it's time to go now.
Yep. Yeah. He's definitely on it now.
But I agree, Rusty. It's awful. I mean, there's a lot of laps to go. I mean, we talk about 29 laps somewhere else is a long time. We see Montoya coming back on the high side. He's got a push from Matt Kenseth. Here comes that eight car again we've talked about. Eric Almirola's done a great job all day.
Well, I tell you, I want to say talking some more about Juan Pablo Montoya. You know, he's had a struggle this year, but boy, this restrictor plate racing looks like this cat has really got this figured out with the good runs he's had all year long on these plate races. And it looks like he said he's gained a lot of respect out of Dale Earnhardt Jr.
And Rusty, what would that mean for Chip Ganassi and Felix Sabatis? I know you speak with Chip very often, but to get that 42 car up back up toward the front. You watch the 88 car now leaving the six, and here comes Montoya again.
Here comes his buddy.
We got a big bump from Montoya right there. Montoya actually even got out of shape a little bit on the straightaway.
Yeah, and the good thing was he had the 17 car right behind him pushing him. So when they can do that, that makes them have a really good run. But here comes Reagan on the inside. He's got Jeff Burton on his bumper.
88. Wow. The 88 car pushed the 6 by the 31, and now the 31 says, I'm going to repay. I'm going to pay you back. I'm going to push the 6 by you, 88.
Well, you got the lap cars right there that were a factor in that. Now that they get these guys clear, you'll see maybe that little move work. I think that's why you saw Reagan able to stay in the lead here.
Yeah, we haven't seen much teammate stuff today. You know, we saw the Gibbs cars up there at one time, but right now the 31, the 29, and the 07 look like they are just all together and that they are intent on working together here towards the end of this race to all get a good finish or give one of them a chance to win.
Look at this. DJ, who do you go with? Is it friendship? Is it teammates? Is it whoever has the fastest car?
You go with the fastest car now, man. Everything else is out the window.
You can feel the intensity coming up out there.
That's why the fans love Talladega, and everyone talked about this being the wild card race. A turning point here in the chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup. Back in the pack, Carl Edwards, top of your screen, still hanging back there. Biffle is back there, and DJ, are you still firm or they need about 8 laps before they make their move?
You know, I mean, somewhere in there, I mean, definitely in the last 15 laps, they need to start making that. But I believe these guys went up there and saw what they could do, how far they could go, and how long it's going to take them.
Yeah, we saw that on that restart. I thought they were experimenting just to see how far they could get up there and how long it would take. And then they went right back where on their strategy. Look at Michael coming up on the outside.
Big That's amazing. Wow, look at that bump. But Michael's on the bumper of Juan Pablo Montoya, pushing him to the front. That's the best thing that might position Michael could be in with the aerodynamics of his race car.
Yeah, he needs to be right up behind another car so he can kind of minimize that drag that damaged car has.
Junior still the leader, though, as all of this is taking place. He's got the 42 right behind him now.
Reed Sorensen going up very, very high behind Kenseth to try to push that outside line up there and give Kenseth a boost.
Here goes Michael Waltrip to the inside.
Back to the outside.
Junior's trying to block everybody up there. He doesn't know which lane to block, which one is coming, but that's what makes him really good at this, is he's able to figure that out most of the time and get that push from behind to keep himself in front. Here comes the outside. Yeah, 42 can really push car. He's pushing Michael Waltrip to the lead. This is amazing. We saw him working on that car, Michael Waltrip's on pit road. This is unbelievable. That I would have thought that that car wouldn't be able to run at all.
He might have a hard time holding the lead if he ever does get there. Because he's got a ton of damage up around the windshield and the roof area. But not to mention what he's got on the front fender and that front end area.
It's hard to believe he's even going to get there, but he continues to move up there with a little help from his friends.
And the other strong car is Jeff Burton. We've seen him a number of times get back there and get to Junior's bumper and give him a big push out there.
They've hung him out to dry right there now. Now here comes his teammate, Kevin Harvick, moving up behind him here.
Look here. Look at this run coming here. Walter's going to get the lead this time. It's a big push. Here comes Kyle Busch.
Oh, look at that big bump. Michael Walker's got to be humming that Beatles too.
Oh, gets by with Kevin Harvick.
Trouble. Harvick on the bottom of the racetrack.
Like he doesn't have any damage yet, other than what the grass did here. Okay, he's got it started up, so he'll stay on the lead lap.
Yeah.
Eighth caution flag of the day.
Good, boys. Put some tires up.
Yeah, he's feeling good today. He didn't hit anything.
Yeah, you don't spin in the middle of that pack too many times and something big not happen. He'll probably go on and come in this time just to get those tires on, make sure something doesn't blow out and mess up.
Yeah, even though he would have to restart.
I believe he looked good.
He would have to restart the tail end. He can come in now and get these tires changed, not lose a lap.
Everything looks all right. Just brought in tires.
Wonder if he got tapped here.
Oh, I would say so.
I think with everything that was going on there.
See that outside lane, it just got such a big push.
Yeah.
Looks like
David Reagan got hit. Yeah. Wow, how this didn't create something major. Wow. Look at this.
Look at Reagan getting by.
Woo. That's some really good driving and a lot of luck. You see.
88's backing up. All right. Just got turned there.
Harvick couldn't go any further up. He was hitting Jeff Burton, so just a product of this type of racing.
I think we're going to see it even get more intense as the laps wind down, too.
Yeah, Kevin get to grasp. blown off of him. Man, that was, whoo.
How did Bragan miss him when he came back across?
Yeah, Kevin did a good job of getting that car to the bottom, too. If that thing goes up the racetrack.
Yeah, he did. He stayed in the throttle and kept it off the track.
Watch Tony Stewart in this frame.
Whoa.
Actually, watch, he's got you. Back down.
See, Kevin, he stayed in the throttle. He's spinning those rear wheels to stay up off the racetrack. Did a great job.
You talked about earlier these bumpers lining up so good on these cars. You saw him get into the back of the 7 car, but it just shoved him forward instead of turning that car, as could happen in years past.
Here
see
comes
if
Mike,
going to pit road.
Michael Waltrip coming on. Kyle Busch is there. Jeff Burton, Kenseth, Bobby Labonte.
Anybody that's close on fuel needs to be on pit road right now.
And Michael Waltrip, last minute, they said they were going to stay out. They had enough fuel, but they decided right sides only for the 55 guys. Shannon?
Jamie, right sides only for Kyle Busch in the 18. Gamble paid off. They did not top off. They need 3 seconds of fuel. Dave?
Johnson thought he might have flat-spotted his tire, so they will give him two rounds up on the track bar, though, for a car that's tight. Mike?
A four-tire change, the call for the 31 team. Team completing its service on the right side, swinging around the left side. No adjustments for Burton.
Race off of pit road there. Kyle Busch gains a spot. You see Michael back one, Bobby Labonte up two. And remember, the 48 car took on four tires and made a major chassis adjustment. He had to back up to be able to get out. Cost him some time. Of course, they're going to have 20 laps when they get the green flag. Let's watch Jimmy. Schrader pitting in front of him.
Yeah, he was kind of angled in the wrong way, and then the 96 car came in front. At that point in time, you just say, well, we're back here. Get what we can get after this thing goes back green.
Four tires for the current reigning champion.
Yeah, 22 laps to go is still a long time here. Just like we said, if you only need about 8 or 10 laps to get to the front, you've got plenty of time with 22 laps. No reason to try to hurry out of the pits and maybe even push something and run into somebody, bend a fender. Just get back here in the back, get ready to go to work.
As they like to say, business is getting ready to pick up.
It's going to pick up. Guys.
I can't tell you how, as intense as this race has been for 166 laps to this point, it magnifies 10 times when you get to a situation like this to where you know that, hey, we've gotten to this point, now let's just let it all go.
Alan, it's about time, and it's already been wild. It's about to get even wilder.
Yeah, and going back to what we talked about on NASCAR Countdown, Doc, earlier in the day, the closer you get to the finish, the more the likelihood of the big wreck. And I'll go right out on a limb on this one. We haven't seen the big wreck yet today.
Oh, we might not have. I was just thinking, with 22 laps to go, guys, they got this wild. What's going to happen with 10 laps to go? I mean, they're already beating each other up out there. We're not even close to the end of the race yet, guys. I mean, that's got to believe there's more to come.
It's been incredible how aggressive these guys have been bump drafting. And I thought in the driver's meeting, they said there's no bump drafting to be done through the corners. It looks like these boys are leaning on each other hard.
And what's incredible is the ability these guys have to control these cars. What Kevin just did was amazing. Keeping that car going back up the racetrack. These guys are driving these cars. So we might not see the big wreck, but we'll probably see a couple more little ones. Yeah.
So 12 guys stayed on the racetrack there. First one off pit road is Kyle Busch. He is going to be back in the field. And then there's Kevin Harvick, who spun, said put four on it. And he's going to be right back in the thick of this thing before the end of it. And then you got Carl Edwards, who did not pit in the initial wave of cars and kept the pattern going like they have all day. Came in the next lap and made his service. And he'll go back and restart at the end of this group. Shannon?
Yep, Alan down here with Steve Addington, crew chief for Kyle Busch. All right, you got two right side tires. You've got the fuel. Currently running right outside the top 10. Are you where you want to be for this last 20 laps?
I think so. I think that the right decision was to put two tires on, give him a little bit of grip through the corners where he could hustle the car and make the moves he needs to make. So we'll see. I feel pretty good having Kyle Busch sitting in my race car with this many laps to go.
And you got to feel pretty good about having Steve Addington on top of the crew chief, on top of the pit box. Dave?
And Brian Petty asked his driver to save fuel just a little bit. Are you okay on fuel to the end?
Plenty good. We're just trying to make sure we're green, white, checkered. We're plenty good. This is fun here. Juan's having a good time, and I just want to thank everybody back in the shop for building this car for us.
It looks like he's made friends with the right guys out there today that will draft with him, the faster cars, would you say?
Who's that?
The 88 for one in particular.
Yeah. He's a real good drafter, like I said, and we've got a decent car, and it's got a little bit of speed, so we'll see what happens. It's not over yet.
All right, a few laps to go, that's for sure, Doc.
27 cars on the lead lap. It'll be less than 20 laps to go. 20 to go next time by. And guys, DJ, you mentioned you want to make your move with you're one of those 27 cars with 8 to go. But on the last lap, where do you want to be? Second, third, fourth, fifth? I mean, we've seen 3 lead changes from turn 4 to the start finish line.
Yeah, if I had my choice, I'd want to be second with somebody that I knew was going to help me. You don't always know that, but if I could make that move, and I'm not going to try to do it until I get to the tri-oval because we've seen passes made there. You make it too early, then you're going to go backwards.
I don't think these guys are going to have a chance. A choice. They're just going to try to get in there, get what they can get. I don't think you can choose to be second with one to go. I mean, no. These guys have been all over each other all day long. I'm like Alan. I don't think we've seen the last of the contact either.
No, wait. You say you don't make your move until the tri-oval, so you're probably, 400 yards from the start-finish line?
Yeah, I think you make it before that. You're going to get passed again but if you try to make it too soon. So I said if I had my choice. Yeah. It's not many of them going to have a choice.
Well, I tell you, this what a great chase this has been so far and what a great finish we have set up here at Talladega. Here's your ticket to the chase. Coming up, we go to Lowe's Motor Speedway, Martinsville, Atlanta, Texas, Phoenix, and of course, we finish it out with a championship weekend at Homestead Miami Speedway, all live on ABC. 29 car will have to start at the tail end of the longest line. Too many men over the wall. Now Harvick had to come in and they had to fix a brace on the splitter and also change tires. But that's not going to hurt him much because everybody's going to be coming from that same spot anyway.
Well, he already, he's got all this damage and everything, so he was going to be back there regardless. But he's lucky to be out there with a car that actually doesn't have any more damage than he does.
Check in on the 15 car. Jamie?
Well, Paul Menard's team opted to stay out that last stop. He's running third right now. They've been top 10 for the majority of the day. Now, you're looking at Doug Randolph, his crew chief. I talked to him a little while ago, and he said, you know, with the news this week, Paul's moving on. This team doesn't know what they're going to do. I don't know where I'm going to be next year. This team doesn't know where they're going to go. What a win would mean for this team to bring this team together in the spirit. He hasn't had a top 10 yet this year. DEI knows how to get it done on super speedways. We're going to hold on, buckle our seatbelts, and see how they do, guys.
Jamie, he is the only driver there in the top 4 that has yet to win, and how special would that be considering how much he appreciates what DEI has done for him, although he's moving on next year. Juan Pablo Montoya, this could turn their year around. The frustrations for Ganassi, Sabatis, and Dodge. Might mention that Denny Hamlin out of the race has been transported to a local hospital for further evaluation. Jeff Gordon out of the race in the garage area with engine difficulties after an accident. He will finish 38th. And we have less than 20 to go at Talladega.
Nice little restart there by Montoya. Casey Mears right on his bumper. This is going to be interesting to see how these guys want to play. I know that you want to try to be leading, but I can't imagine that's the place to be whenever we get down to that final lap. But you got to get yourself in that position somewhere in that top 5 if you're going to have a shot at winning.
Casey Mears began the day on pins and needles, knowing that they were expecting the birth of his first child back in Charlotte. He was thinking about getting out of the car. If she went into labor, the head back there, she has not. He said, I'm going to stay in race, and it might end up for a very special day for Casey trying to hold on to second spot.
It's going to be interesting to watch as we see these first 6 cars have broken away just a little bit, but actually the first 7 there. These other guys are coming.
We still don't know who the players are going to be in this mix for the win. I mean, it could come from somebody all the way at the back of this pack right now.
No.
Look at this, 4 wide, all the way down on the inside. David Reagan up there on the outside getting a little push from the 17 of Kenseth and Nemechek.
Yeah, we got Johnson and Edwards back in this group. Our pole sitter, Travis Quaffle, right there.
Kyle Busch, yep.
Michael Waltrip, who was just leading the race a while ago. So they got plenty of time. They just, they're wanting to get in. They're wanting to be the ones in position that leads this group to the front.
As you said, guys, the top 7 single file, but now the second pack is reeling them in.
Yeah, just take a couple of laps, and they're going to, when they come, and that's the thing about it right now, is when that outside lane comes and they've got a fast car leading them, they're going to come fast, and that's when the guys up front are going to have to decide exactly what they're going to do. Are they going to stick with their plan to stay right there in the bottom, or one of these guys in that first 7, are they going to jump out there and try to be leading that front group?
I think that's the key, that top 7 right there. If they stay lined up, it's going to be slow going, but now we see the 20 car. We see Tony Stewart now starting to move up on the outside. Now somebody else moves up. And when they see this group coming, yep, these other guys will pop up right in front of them like this. Jamie?
Well, Andy, the 20 car was running up front. It was all by design 20 laps ago when it started getting crazy in that front pack. His spotter said, drop back. It's getting crazy. That's exactly what Tony did, drop back to about 30th. Now he's making his way forward, finding his friends and seeing if he can make it back to the end before the end of the race. Dave?
Jamie, Casey Mears working the low line in that five car, at least the last time around, and he still is in second place there. Crew Chief Alan Gustafson told me this morning he wasn't surprised that they were not good, that they were good. He was surprised that they qualified second, and that changed their strategy for the day. They've run up front most of the day and been near the front pack, as now they get that challenge on the outside.
Tony Stewart on the high side gets a little help from the 17 car, Matt Kenseth.
As you can see, as Matt pushed him out there, then Tony lost his partner to push him right at that point. So they were able to come back on the inside. Now they're just lined up double file for about three rows, and then it's triple wide after that.
Now give a call to the 22 car, Dave Blaney, who had electrical troubles early on. They were able to work on the car through several pit stops, and now Blaney in the Bill Davis car being shown in the eighth position. There's a 22 right in front of Dale Jr.
He's got some good help right there with that 88 car pushing. See that? He gets a big shove up through the middle.
Yeah, I didn't think Dale Jr. was going to want to stay down that bottom. You get down that bottom and you're trapped there.
That was a close call right there.
Woo. Oh, got trouble up front.
Biffle right in front of Jr.
Carl
Kids
Edwards
is in it.
Oh, and turns Quapple into the outside
wall. Around them.
And
Kevin, a lot of chasers involved in this one.
Oh.
17.
Now when you get off there, if you could drive it.
This is definitely the big one we were looking for, guys. I was hoping we had not seen, or we had seen it, and we wouldn't see this, but
these guys hung back all day, and that's what they get in then.
We don't have any brakes.
We told her, look at Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car all torn up in the front. We mentioned Talladega could be the turning point in the chase.
This is definitely a turning point for these guys right here. Yes. All these chasers involved.
Carl Edwards all day long tried to stay out of trouble. You see Juan Pablo Montoya headed to the garage area. 17 involved.
Your teammates there in the 99 took you guys out.
Biffle's car's destroyed.
Interesting to see on the replay exactly what did happen.
Travis Quapple, the pole sitter, brand new car. Heavy damage on his car after having such a great run. Oh, 22, Dave Blaney. Harvick also damaged. He's sitting on pit road there, right side and left front damage.
Do you need another pen, Doc? I see you writing all these numbers down. Are you out of ink?
I'm running out of ink. Just writing people down in this incident here. Again, Biffle, Edwards, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Kenseth, 29 of Harvick. There's Carl Edwards, who had spent all day trying to stay out of trouble, trying to dodge people on pit road, even pitting a lap late to stay away from contact. Ah.
Yeah, that's frustrating to have a car as good as Travis Quapple had today to end like that.
Yeah, and he was almost by it, got clipped in the right rear, and that's what's so frustrating for him.
Let's show you again here. 14 laps to go, and the big one, two, takes place.
You can see these guys coming on the high side. See Carl Edwards and Greg Biffle up on the high side making a real run. You see Blaney gets turned a little bit there, but that was okay. That looked like that could be big. But the trouble's going to start right up here in the front whenever looks like maybe the 99 gets into the back of the 16. That's all three Roush cars that it takes out right there. And Dale Jr.
Look at Jimmy Johnson just squeezed by this. There's still some wrecking ahead of even of Jimmy Johnson yet.
We talk about bump drafting. It's hard to see from that angle we were right there, but bump drafting in the corners. You have to believe that Biffle got a shot right there. I don't think that the car would just turn sideways. Jimmy Johnson right there in the middle, just behind Kevin Harvick, who was involved in the accident, but Jimmy Johnson's going to slip through. See Jeff Burton down the apron. Let's watch right here.
Still free. Keep pushing. Keep pushing.
Right there. You cannot touch somebody right there on that left rear corner.
You just can't keep hitting them, especially in that corner. You got the wheels turned already, and you just have to lay off right at that point. As much as you're wanting to help move forward,
Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s onboard camera. You see the contact right in front of him there, and he'll have nowhere to go.
One inside, spin in front of you. Come on, come on, come on.
We're in it, guys. Keep digging there. You're clear low when you get around them.
Yeah, that's a hard hit, too.
There you go. Come on, when you get off there, if you could drive it.
See, Junior chose to get up in that outside line. He saw them moving, but wasn't expecting that to happen. Wow, that 48 car was just amazing getting through there, too.
This is Kevin Harvick now. See, he kind of gets by this first part right here.
All right. Come on, stand it.
We're in it.
Yeah, then he got hit two or three different times.
These are the moves that can win a championship. Watch Jimmy Johnson.
Go the middle, go the middle. Hell yeah, watch it still crashing. Go down. Watch him.
See the 55 get hit from behind back there by Kevin Harvick. Michael looked like he was getting by it, but Jimmy Johnson, that was just
Reagan. David Reagan did a great job getting through there.
Yeah, that's
he
great
drove
job
through all of that
by those two drivers.
Let's listen to Jimmy's radio.
Did not hit a thing. Sam riding around dead last from here on out.
There's only like five cars left. Can't we at least try to go for the win?
No, you have no idea how lucky we are. I mean, I'm telling you what. We better still think lucky too, because it's not over.
But I was just teasing. Did you hit anything or lock anything up?
Touch a freaking soul.
That's not the first time that's been said by a driver, I'll assure you. You thought that exact same thing. Shannon, you're with Greg Biffle.
Yeah, down here, climbed out of his car. You hung out in the back all race long. You looked like you were just starting to make your move. What happened?
I don't know really what happened. Well, I think that the 99 tried to give us just a little help there in the center of the corner and got us turned around. But same old Talladega, you know, it's hung out in the back all day. And they should make these races 20 laps to get our fans the money's worth. But I'm fortunate for the guys that worked really hard, built me a great car. And I felt like we drove really smart all day. You know, went up through the pack a few times. But just hate it for the guys, hate it for 3M. I know it hurt us in the points, but, you know, we got six more. We knew this was a wild card.
How do you refocus moving forward to the next six races? I mean, looking at what you've been able to do so far in the chase, obviously.
Well, I mean, we just look at Charlotte, you know, as positive. You know, we ran really, really good there in the test here just a little while back. So you just can't expect anything out of Talladega.
All right, Greg Biffle, this 16 car guy's done for the day. Doc?
This is a 10-car crash, the big one, too. The big one, number one, took place on lap 68. There were nine cars involved. This one was even bigger. And this one involved a lot of chase contenders. You mentioned Biffle Edwards, their original contact, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Matt Kenseth involved, the 29, Kevin Harvick involved. Others who were non-chasers are the 41 of Sorensen, 55, Michael Waltrip, 42 of Montoya, 22 of Dave Blaney, the 28 of Travis Quappel.
This is our second red flag of the day.
Jeff Burton did a great job getting down across the racetrack. Both he and teammate Clint Boyer.
Still inside. In front of you. Stay down. Slower down. Come on. Still wrecking. Easy. Tiptoe through there. Go ahead and pull up a little bit. We're getting through this, guys. Piece of cake. Good job.
Jeff's wife, Kim Burton, can't imagine the emotion she's feeling when she sees a big cloud of smoke and doesn't see the 31 car, and then it appears. What a relief that must be. Let's go down where Shannon is caught up with Jack Roush.
Doc, three Roush Fenway Racing cars involved in that wreck. Jack, what did you see happen? The 18 and the 16 and the 99 looked like they were starting to make their move to the front.
Well, they were doing that. You know, these cars are organized so that with the bumpers that line up front and back. NASCAR let people push through the corners and push down the straightaways. They'd pushed one another all day. And I guess Carl got into to Greg too hard, and he turned him sideways, and that caused the big wreck. Some days are harder than others. It's a real hard day. Talladega is a tough place. You come here and you run around the back, which they did, and try to stay out of trouble, trying to avoid somebody else's wreck, and then unfortunately you can be in making the charge for the front. You can get involved in your own wreck.
Yeah, what an emotional chase for Roush Fenway Racing. The highs of the last 3 weeks and now the lows of Talladega. Mike?
And catching up with another chaser who was involved, Kevin Harvick. Saw you looking at the monitor. What could you tell happened?
I looked like the 99 should have drafted all day, because obviously he wasn't ready to start racing there until the end. And
and made a mistake and tore up most of the field. But just really proud of my Shell Pennzoil guys. We spun out there. We weren't going to sit back there and ride all day. That's not what these race fans pay to see. They pay to see us race. And it wasn't David Reagan's fault or anything when he spun out. We just all got jammed up there just racing really hard. So it was a lot of fun. Just hate for it to get tore up like that. We'll try to get back out and limp around there.
Can you give me a little perspective? I mean, you know, every time you come here, this is a possibility. What's this like going through this in the midst of a championship hunt?
It's just Talladega. I mean, it's just, you know, you got a 50-50 opportunity to come here and miss the wreck, and today we got in it.
Disappointed Kevin Harvick, but still he manages a smile, Jamie.
And Mike, all the drivers just being released. First of all, Matt, are you okay? Hard hit there.
Yeah, I'm fine.
What happened? What did you see?
Well, I didn't really see it. I just saw the 16 was turned. I guess Carl said he turned the 16, I guess. So I didn't see it. I just saw 16's left front fender, and I thought we were doing all right getting to the front there. And I pulled left as far as I could, and I just couldn't miss it. 16 got wiped out, and he wiped me out somehow.
Three teammates involved in that. Glad to see Matt Kenseth. Okay, we'll move over here to Carl Edwards. Carl, we saw the replay of the video. You and the 16 got together. What happened there that led to all this?
I was just pushing Greg as hard as I could. It's my fault. And I apologize to everybody caught up in that wreck. I mean, we'd been pushing each other a lot, and it'd been going really well. And he just, I just pushed him. I guess we got in exactly the wrong spot there going into three, and he got real loose, and that was just the way it went. But it's my fault, and I feel bad that I took my teammates out. I know Matt's mad, and I'm sure Greg's mad, but you just do the best you can and hope for the best, and just didn't work out today. I always worry about the idiots when we come here, and I was the guy that caused that one.
Carl, you hung in the back most of the day, the strategy that you wanted, but then you guys need your teammates to run together. Talk about the strategy, and was it the right time for you to make that move?
I don't know that there was a right time to make that move, but it was going well. You know, we went down the back straightaway, and I thought I could get Greg out there clear of Tony, and we'd be in a pretty good position with, you know, 13 or 14 to go, or however many laps were left. So just do the best you can. Sometimes things like this happen.
All right, guys, Carl Edwards came in second in points. We'll have to see how this all shakes down. Shannon?
Yeah, Jamie, down here, Dale Earnhardt Jr. just addressing some of the media out of the Infield Care Center. Dale, are you okay?
Yeah.
Can you tell me what happened from your perspective?
Well, I was running along there, and the 16 turned sideways. 99 had him hooked off in the corner. And he went down and hit Matt, and they turned up in front of me. I couldn't do nothing I could do. I was just sitting there trying to get to the front, man. I was getting ready to have to be ugly. You know, we'd push the people out of the way to get into the middle lane because the bottom wasn't the way to go. And just running along there, trying to make something happen. And I'm, you know, running the mat pretty hard. I'm glad everybody's all right.
Dale, you were so strong all day. You've said how much you love racing here at Talladega. That is obvious to everybody. How aggressive did it get out there towards this wreck?
It's not that aggressive. That was just some simple errors made. It's pretty rough on the bumping. Them guys need to learn how to bump, a couple of them. They just hit too hard, and it's just not doing anything. Doesn't accomplish anything, so really, just aggravates you. But some of us know how to bump draft really good, and we do it real good. And we like to work with each other. Me and Juan were having an awesome time out there working together. And I had to dump Jimmy on the back straightaway, and he got real mad at me. But I didn't want to go in the top groove. The middle was the way to be, and I was going to try to get to work with him a little bit more, pay him back for that because I did him wrong. But it was a lot of fun. My car was really good. I'm sorry for my team having tearing up race cars. We ain't going to spend this much time, put this many man hours in the next plate race because ain't no telling what's going to happen anyways. We got good stuff. It don't matter what we bring to the racetrack. But it was a little nerve-wracking with the tires blowing. I was nervous about having my tire blow for no reason. I already had one blow already for no reason this weekend, and we had a lot more blowing for no reason. We had a lot blowing in the ARCA race. Them Hoosier tires ain't doing no better. It's some kind of combination to do with the surface, obviously, than the tire, but that made me nervous. But you got to run. And I was hoping we could pull off a win, man. We sure needed one.
All right, certainly a busy weekend for Dale Earnhardt Jr. Doc?
Under a red flag, Shannon, 11 cars now the total involved. To add to that the list of chasers, the sixth chaser involved Kyle Busch, his damaged car on pit road. Other chasers, Biffle, Edwards, Earnhardt, Kenseth, Harvick. And there sits the 18 of Kyle waiting to get some repairs as soon as the red flag is listed. We are under a red flag with 14 laps to go. Back after this from our ABC stations.
back at Talladega Super Speedway, the Amp Energy 500 under the second red flag today, and they have given the command to fire the engines back again. They will allow the teams on pit road to begin some of the repairs. Again, an 11 car crash. And they will again now wave the caution flag. Once they wave the caution flag and pull in the red, you can begin to work on the cars in the garage area and on pit road. There is the work being done on the 55 of Michael Waltrip that led earlier today. We have set two records here, a record for different leaders, an all-time NASCAR Sprint Cup Series record. 28 different cars have led this race today. There have been 64 lead changes. Been an eventful day for chasers. Jeff Gordon back in the garage area. Six other chasers involved. But we do have a chase contender leading right now. Tony Stewart, let's visit with his crew chief. Jamie?
Greg Zipidelli. So, Greg, you guys leading this thing right now. 13 laps to go. Is this the spot you want to be in?
We either want to be all the way in the back where we were, or we want to be in the front. A lot of stuff's happened today. These guys have done a great job, the Subway, Home Depot, Toyota. It's run good all weekend. We kind of had to battle back from our little crash and happy hour. Proud of all the guys here for what they've done. And we've had a pretty good car, so we got to keep our fingers crossed and hopefully we get tied up with the right people here for the last little bit.
Before this big one, you guys, it got a little dicey, but the spotter said, Tony, back off. It's getting crazy. How important was that call to avoid that big one?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we were right in the right place. We had just taken the lead and the third and fourth place car wrecked. So, you can't, you just never know here where it's going to happen or what happens. It's a really small line, of overdoing it. And fortunately, we've been able to so far stay out of it and keep our fingers crossed here.
All right, Tony Stewart looking for his first win in 2008 and here at Talladega. Dave?
And that would be for Casey Mears as well, Jamie. How is your driver avoiding all those wrecks out there today?
He's doing a good job in that Pop-Tarts CarQuest Chevrolet. It was really close. We were real close to this one down here, and Eddie Mace cup our spotter, and Casey did a really good job. And Casey just got it done down there. I think either the 38 or the 6 or somebody broke the momentum that 99 so we could get underneath them. But it's been a good day for the guys, good day on pit road, and hopefully we can get one here.
Looks like the car has all the speed that it showed in qualifying.
It does. It's out there. You can go up and back. It's a pinball here, but we've been up more than we've been back. It's a good thing. You want to be up front at the end of the race, so it'd be nice to be second or third with the two to go and get a shot at it.
All right, there's the strategy right there. Second or third with two to go, guys. What do you think?
I think he's got a shot. Got a great race car, and he knows he's been the victim before. He was running third at Daytona with six laps to go and got taken out. He was the highest finishing Hendrick car here in April with a top 10 finish.
Leaders, a lot of guys coming for tires. Yeah, you saw them having to avoid this wreck. And probably got some flat spots and debris on these tires. They want to get them all off of there. Shannon?
It's going to be four tires for Clint Bowyer. They think they may have a little bit of damage from that wreck. They're just going to check it out. But the 07 survived that wreck. Dave?
Jimmy Johnson will come to pit road. They will put four fresh tires on that car. And they're still trying to decide kind of whether or not they're going to go for it here at the end or play conservative. Mike?
Yeah, Jeff Burton in now. He came on the radio just after that incident happened and said, guys, we barely escaped that one. They just scooted right through. No damage on the 31 as they complete their stop now and they're away.
Major adjustments you saw in the back of that 48 car, Andy.
Yeah, they keep changing the car, freeing it up every stop. They raised the track bar the last stop and took a little wedge out that on this one here. So even though handling is not a big issue, I guess Jimmy's feeling something there. He just wants his car to be a little freer.
Let's update Jimmy Johnson's day. It was very uneventful at the start. He was dropping to the back and he dropped too far to the back and lost the draft and got a lap down in the first 25 laps. Lap 54, there's the incident in front of him. He gets a big chunk of rubber, Goodyear carcass on the hood of his Chevy. And here's the first big one of the day, 9 car crash, and watch Jimmy weave his way through.
Seems still driving the car here. You can get back in the throttle trying to avoid these guys.
Now big one number 2, this time 11 cars.
Yeah, this was just incredible, the job that he did get in between this, because they were wrecking above him and below him, and there were cars that were all around him that got involved in that, but he was able to miss it again. Dave?
So when you had all that go well near the end of this race, do you live with that or do you try for some more? Jimmy and Chad discuss.
Here's the situation. You can be aggressive and try to go for the win,
So you can go for the win to try to capitalize and get more points, or you can go the conservative route and just try to finish and get minimal points.
I'm going to take it as it comes. Need to do better at that than anything. Really, the other side of it, too, is I have used up all my luck for one day. There's something in me saying just be smart here, because I can't.
What do you think of that, crew chief? What should he do?
He's going to, like you said, play it by ear. And I'll guarantee you, if that wins in grasp, Jimmy Johnson will go for it. He's not going to take any chances to get it, but I'll guarantee you he'll go for it if it's there.
The chasers have had their woes at Talladega today. 9 of the 12 chasers have been involved in some sort of incident. We documented Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon in the garage area. He's done for the day. Denny Hamlin had been taken to a local hospital for evaluation. He was awake and alert. Carl Edwards looped it coming off of pit road. Harvick the spin. And those guys involved in the crash. The only three that haven't had an issue are Stewart, Tony Stewart, Jeff Burton, and Clint Bowyer. But we still have 11 laps to go.
Yeah, it's not because they hadn't been in position to get in something. They've just been a little more fortunate than the others. And I can assure you that you're talking about Jimmy Johnson. If he's going to try to win this race, he's going to have to take some chances. Because there's a lot of guys up there. Tony Stewart hasn't won this year. Joe Nemechek hasn't won in a while. Casey Mears hasn't won in a long time. Elliott Sadler's been won. We've got a lot of hungry drivers that are going to do whatever it's going to take. So Jimmy's going to have to make a decision. The wild part of this, we've eliminated a lot of drivers that from the issue, but this. We're not finished with this. It's going to get crazy again.
And in that top five, David Ragan has never won a NASCAR Sprint Cup race. Remember, you heard Alan Bestwick tell you earlier, this race, this track has produced 9 first-time winners.
Yeah, you look at our top eight, and we've got guys up there. A few of them have won, but we've got quite a few that haven't won, and some of those that have won haven't won in a while. So,
and this is a golden opportunity, and they know it. They see this right there. It's something they can actually attain, so they're going to be on it.
Yeah, this is their chance.
Showing you where the leaders are starting. Tony Stewart, 350th
like
career start.
Race with all the cars that are left.
You got Terry Labonte, Ken Schrader, Kenny Wallace, all on the lead lap here in the top 20.
And these guys at one point in time were all at least one lap down, but they've hung in there, made it work, but it's going to get exciting again. Tony Stewart leads them to the green.
43 races for Tony Stewart without a victory in NASCAR Sprint Cup going back to Watkins Glen in 2007. He has never won at Talladega in 20 starts. This is his 20th start today. He has finished second 6 times.
Yeah, that's a pretty amazing stat that he's put himself in position that many times to win, and it just hasn't gone his way. But this could be the opportunity he's looking for to see Joe Nemechek giving Tony a push down the back straightaway on this restart.
Elliott Sadler hanging right there with him. Elliott now backing up about 4 or 5 car lengths.
You don't want to get too big a lead. These two cars just kind of shot out there about 5 or 6 car lengths. The danger here is when these guys get organized behind you, they'll come like a freight train when they get there, because they're going to come back to these leaders.
Elliott's backed up to David Ragan, trying to get a push now from Ragan, see if the second line can catch him and go by him. Here they come.
Yeah, we honestly have about 14 cars that are probably capable of winning this race still.
Now Tony goes up and makes a big block on Elliott Sadler.
Elliott knows how to get it done at these places. He's won some of the 150-mile qualifying races at Daytona. Hasn't ever won here. Yeah, he knows the good and the bad here. He's run awfully well, but he's also ended up on his roof. So, but he is glued to Tony Stewart's bumper
right now. He is right there.
We've seen this a couple of times. Just two cars get hooked up together and how they get away from everybody.
Still don't think that's a good thing to get that far out ahead of these guys.
I don't know. I'll take my chances. Let's get away from the rest of these before something else happens.
Well, there's still 8 laps to go that time by.
Toyota and Dodge, Subway and McDonald's could be a little battle of brands here. These final laps. Mike.
Well, Doc, if Elliott Sadler is able to pull this off, there will be somebody back at home cheering real hard. That's his crew chief, Rodney Childers. Childers is not here. He left on Friday because his wife gave birth to twin boys. Instead, Kevin Kidd is on top of the pit box, calling the shots for Elliott Sadler this weekend and trying to push that 19 car to victory. Elliott holding his spot right now behind Tony Stewart, looking for the win.
Only seven laps to go this time by.
They've got a huge lead right now.
Yeah. Elliott and I are scheduled to fly to Florida from here for a couple of days for some business, and I'll be glad to wait on him if he wants to go to Victor Lane. That won't be a problem.
DEI cars back there, including the rookie Regan Smith and the 0-1. Now six is Reagan and the two DEI cars of Smith and Menard.
Yeah, here comes a fast car. We've talked about David Reagan all day, and we've wondered, does he have the experience to know what to do at the end of this race with a fast race car to win? I feel like that he got through that wreck a while ago. It was pretty amazing that he was able to, so he might look at this best chance to win here.
David Reagan has gone 67 races without a victory. Now they go on the inside of him. The DEI cars hook up together. Menard pushing Regan Smith, the rookie, up in the back of Tony Stewart.
Yeah, they've hung Elliott Sadler out. You see Jeff Burton coming up through here. Another driver hungry for a win. He's got four fresh tires also.
Jimmy Johnson kind of vanished from the screen, taking the conservative approach, I'm assuming.
That's interesting because this isn't getting them a huge lead in the points by any means. So kind of interesting they would opt for this choice.
That big wreck sure changed the complexion of the race. We saw it was really crazy with three wide,
yeah,
six, seven deep. Now we're seeing single file racing that we haven't seen all day long.
No, but I don't think we're through seeing our double wide racing here. I think we see these first six cars in your screen there and seven with the 66 car there. But there's a group right behind them that is catching them. So I think that they're going to be in the mix before this is over.
Yeah, that's 14 cars. The very back car of this 14 is the 00 of Kenny Wallace. Now all these are on the lead lap. First to 14th. There's Kenny.
Five to go.
Right side of your screen.
About Regan Smith and say, we haven't talked about him all day long. And here he is right up there in the middle of this. Scott Riggs doing a great job once again.
Five laps to go, and Regan Smith is in that second spot that you said you wanted to be in.
That's where I wanted to be.
25-year-old Regan Smith. How old you imagine you're at Talladega and you're chasing a two-time Cup champion, Tony Stewart, with five laps to go.
They're starting to organize a little bit behind these guys, trying to form another lane. You see Jeff Burton's car just kind of peeking out there on the outside.
Yeah, he got kind of shuffled out there. Here comes another DEI car filling that space. So they're second, third, and fourth right now.
They got the numbers.
Four laps to go.
Yeah, they got a tough man in front to try to pass Tony Stewart.
31 and 07 hooking up on the high side. Two of the Richard Childress cars. There is Burton and Clint Bowyer. If they can get that high groove to work, looks like that Elliott Sadler might move up there with them. Coming up next, ABC World News or your local news. All in the completion of our coverage here. Final four laps at Talladega Super Speedway.
Who's going to be content on just a good finish?
Have something that's in turn problem. Two here.
Yellow. Put debris up at two.
Jamie McMurray's car slowing off of turn two. Looks like cut tire.
Yeah, it looks like a right rear tire has gone flat on the 26. This is probably going to set up a green light checker.
This is going to make things more interesting because it's going to be harder for them to get organized and make moves on a green-white checker, or if we may just have two laps to go, depending on how long it takes them to get cleaned up.
Okay, DJ, if you're Tony Stewart and you got the lead, hang on, I'll ask you just a moment. Let's show you what happened here to McMurray over in the corner.
Blew that right rear tire and didn't hit anything. Sure, there's a lot of debris up there in turn two.
They clean this up. He comes down pit road to get some tires on. Now, Dale Jarrett, you're Tony Stewart. You said you wanted to be in second or third or fourth, and you're leading and you basically with a green-white checkered. What can you do?
Well, right now, you know, if I'm Tony Stewart, I'm liking that the situation is like this. The only thing is knowing now that my spotters probably told me that the DEI cars are second, third, and fourth, and that they're going to try to make a move on me. So it's not like that Tony can back up from this point. He's got to try to protect the lead from this point. He can't try to get himself in second or third because he's going to fall further back than that.
And like I said a while ago, this race changed when all of those cars got in that wreck and we took out really half of the competition. And that changes the strategy here. I think that Tony Stewart can actually probably defend this position better with just this many cars on the track than he could when all the other cars were out there.
Yeah, and we talk about the DEI cars. Now, what are they? Are they going to literally work together? Because you got three drivers that have never won a Sprint Cup race there in those three cars. So which one of them really wants to win, and who's going to help the other one to win and get his first victory?
And what about the history at Talladega? The last three October races have been won with a last lap pass to the checkered flag. We are setting up for what should be an electrifying finish. And speaking of electrifying, how about Monday Night Football returning tomorrow with two of the most electrifying players in the backfield with Adrian Peterson and the Minnesota Vikings taking on Reggie Bush and the New Orleans Saints. Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern time. Coverage begins at 7 Eastern with Monday Night Countdown delivered by UPS. Mike Tirico and the gang. Let's check in on Regan Smith's pits. Shannon.
Yep, down here with Regan Smith's crew chief. You got to tell me, what are you telling your driver over the radio right now? You've got your teammates around you, the 20 in front of you.
Well, we're actually in a pretty good spot. You know, this is what you shoot for all race long, is to be in the front like this with your teammates behind you. So we're ready for the end of the race here, see what happens.
Yeah, and I asked him how he feels, and he said, I'm excited.
They should be excited, Shannon. And, you know, the week began, guys. Everyone was talking about DEI. What's going to happen to DEI? Paul Menard's leaving. Maybe the Army's gone. The sponsorship gone. They would have four cars next year with three drivers left and one major sponsor. People were saying, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? They come here and put all four cars in the top 10 in qualifying. Now they sit second, third, and fourth with three laps to go. What a performance. Jamie.
And Doug Randolph, crew chief for the 15 car. Best run you guys have ever had. I just broke the news and said, you guys aren't sure what you're doing after this. What would a win mean today, Doug?
Oh, win would be huge. The Menard Chevrolet has been running really good all day today. DEI has had a tough week as a company, but as a company, this is the only way we can answer. So hopefully three teammates, we can team up on the 20 car and then let our teammates sort it out, I think.
Is this the best position you can be in right now?
It's all we could hope for right now.
All right, let's sit back and see if the DEI team can work together, Mike.
Well, Jamie, normally Kevin Kitty's the team engineer on the 19. Today, though, the substitute crew chief, and not doing too bad. Can you pull off the upset and get to victory lane?
Oh, yeah. You know, it's Talladega, so anybody can pull off the upset. It's definitely a wild race out there. It always is at Talladega. You know, I think we have a good car, and Ellie Sadler's one of the best drafters in the business. So I really hope our monopoly of McDonald's Dodge can end up victory lane at the end of this thing.
You know, a week ago, you didn't know you were going to be on this pit box. What's this like, stepping into this role and having such a good run?
Well, you know, it's flattering that the team came to me to do this, but at the same time, you know, we can't replace our team director, Rodney Childers. I want to say hi to him and Katrina and the boys, as well as Tommy Wheeler and his wife and their new children. It's been an interesting weekend at Gillette Everett Motorsports. Two sets of twins for people in our team. But, you know, it's just something that the way we work, we all work together as a group. And so, you know, it's real easy to plug and play when the time comes to do that.
Doc, I don't know what kind of an omen it is, but two members of this team this weekend both had twins.
Indicating it's got to be a very special weekend, and Elliott Sadler would love to be able to finish it off with a huge victory at Talladega.
Must be something in the water over there at Gillette Everett. Two sets of twins, huh?
We told you how history has been so significant here with regard to finishes at Talladega. 2005, Dale Jarrett able to get by Tony Stewart and Matt Kenseth to take the victory. The last time Ford won at Talladega. 2 years ago, Brian Vickers running third, contact with a 48 car into Dale Earnhardt Jr. Vickers would win the race. Jr. would finish in second position. And then a year ago, from the back of the pack, Jeff Gordon had not led a single lap until the final lap of the race. He's able to go by his teammate, Jimmy Johnson, and hold him off. And Gordon took the win and the points lead leaving Talladega. There have been 15 last lap passes here at Talladega history, including 4 of the last 6 races. So that's what typically happens here, and folks, stay tuned.
Yeah, this is the one attempt we'll have at a green-white checkered here. It'll be interesting to see. I tell you, just looking at this, those 3 DEI cars, you got to figure they're going to try to go to the high side. Tony Stewart's going to try to block that. If Elliott Sadler can keep David Reagan and Jeff Burton behind him, that inside lane might open up there. Tony can't block everywhere, as you said.
Yeah, he can. And there's a couple guys out there that actually have some fuel issues. They're hearing that the 5 car had to make a pit stop because they couldn't pick up the fuel they had in the tank. What little bit they had.
Getting ready to find out who's going to do what. They're one hanging back a little bit, trying to get a run on Tony. He's smart enough. He's not going to let those guys get too far behind him there. But you can see that the 8 car held back quite a bit. Elliott Sadler's going to try to pass him. Yeah, there they go. Yeah, that wasn't a good move on Eric Almirola's part there. He's going to lose that spot, maybe more.
So now you've only got 2 DEI cars there in that line. Or you had 3.
Yeah. And that can make a huge difference when it comes down to trying to draft past Tony Stewart.
David Reagan now trying to, right on the back side of Elliott Sadler. Remember, he was able to push Sadler by a moment ago.
You know, in this scenario, I talked about waiting until the very last lap and coming through the trial. Well, the bad thing with this is there's only one attempt. If the cost, if these guys wreck now, then you blow that chance. So in this scenario, you might not can wait that long.
Coming out of turn 4, it'll be white flag this time by for Tony Stewart. Regan Smith, the rookie behind him. Menard is there. Sadler is there. Here comes Elliott Sadler.
Yeah, he's not getting any help, though. He made a great move there, but nobody wanted to go with him.
I can't believe that these guys at DEI cars are going to be satisfied with 2nd and 3rd. They're going to have to go for it here.
Now watch the 31 and the 07. Teammates for Childress, Burton, and Boyer.
They want to run single file.
They're all trying, wanting to go, but everybody's just filling that spot, so they're not getting that opportunity.
David Reagan hasn't won. Regan Smith, the rookie. Paul Menard is there. Tony Stewart has never won at Talladega in a NASCAR Sprint Cup car.
He's going to have to do a lot of blocking right here. They've got to run on him. Got to run.
Here they come.
I can't go down there and do that, though.
It's legal on the last lap. He might have got it right there. I think it's legal on the last lap. We're looking next door to see.
Below the yellow line. We
still haven't got an indication, but it looks like Regan Smith won this race.
Why would it be legal on the last lap?
That's what they were
187.
You heard Tony Stewart, some of those guys commenting on you can't go below the yellow line to make that pass. There's Tony inside the car. We are waiting to get definitive information from NASCAR.
He definitely passed below the yellow line pretty much the whole way.
John Darby, Mike Kelly are having a discussion.
We'll see. Good effort.
Here's the replay again. Watch a 0-1.
And he got forced down there. I mean, Tony Stewart actually forced him down a little bit.
Well, yeah, if you're going to consider that he only. Yeah.
They are saying Tony Stewart has won the race. Tony Stewart is the official winner here at Talladega. They would not allow that pass below the yellow line.
That's the only way that can be. You can't go. You can't race one way for 187 laps and change on the last lap. You have to be able to take the same deal.
Look at this one at Talladega.
Great win for Tony Stewart and his team.
And the 43 race winless streak for Tony Stewart ends on a wild afternoon at Talladega, Alabama.
Well, you got to hand it to Regan Smith. He gave it all he had. That's the only shot he had.
Well, yeah, no, that's there for a reason. So you have to make the move to the outside. I mean, you know, obviously the rule's in place for a reason. And so, you know, he gave it a shot. But, you know, again, it forces you to make that move to one side. And it would have been interesting to see. He had a run if he could have taken that to the outside.
Yeah, he did have a little bit of a run. And if he takes it to the outside, it looked like he was going to. He actually tried to fake Tony to the outside.
Yeah. And I'm sure that's going to be his argument that Tony forced him there.
And he does have somewhat of an argument. I guess, yeah. You know, it depends on how you look at it.
Let's check in where Shannon is caught up with his crew chief.
That's right, winning crew chief Greg Zipidelli. Tony Stewart's last race here at Talladega is in the 20 car and his first win. How meaningful is this to you?
I can't even explain it. After the year we've had and what we went through on Friday, it's just, I don't know, I don't know what to say. I'm just so proud of everybody. Joe Gibbs Racing, proud of all my guys, proud of all the guys that came over and helped us get this car back the way it was. It was a team effort. We had people from the 18, people from the 11. We flew people down early. Proud of everybody. And we went to Talladega. I don't even know what to say. This is cool. I love these places. They just, they've been good to us. They just haven't been great. And just proud of everybody. I mean, I can't, I don't know what to say.
Well, one thing is for sure, it's going to be an emotional victory lane.
Tony Stewart's 20th trip to Talladega. He had finished second six times, and he almost finished second again, but it was not to be because the rules are the rules, and they would not allow Regan Smith to go below the yellow line. You could go below if you're forced there, but you cannot advance your position. So Tony Stewart wins it. Let's go down to Mike.
And catching up now with Regan Smith, take me through that last lap move.
Well, I knew I was going to get one shot at him, and Paul was back there pushing me. I backed it up a little bit going into three, and I knew where I was going to make my move at. And I don't know. I always got told that the rule is if you get forced down there, then you're the winner of the race. On the last lap, anything goes. That's, they always say it in the driver's meeting, and that's what I was going with. I got forced down there, man. I had a nose inside of them, and I could have piled up the whole field, and I guess that would have been a cooler finish. I don't know, but I'm proud of DEI. I'm proud of the Principal Fanosha Group. Everybody on this team, ECR engines were awesome. It was a great day for us. We're trying to get this car funded for next year, and you know, second sucks. That's all I can say.
We don't know right now if you are second. NASCAR has not placed you yet. Where do you feel like you should be placed?
Doing burnouts out there right now.
You can tell the disappointment, but still there's reason to be excited about this run for Regan Smith and DEI. An awfully strong effort, Shannon.
Yeah, Mike, a tremendous effort by DEI down here with Paul Menard. Got to take me through that last lap. What was that like from your perspective?
Well, it was a, you know, it's play racing, so it's hard to make a move. You know what I mean? I thought Regan had that. That was cool to see him beat him to the line, but I guess he went underneath the yellow line or whatever. But you know, DEI horsepower, ECR engines. Very cool day for DEI, and I'm definitely looking forward to finishing out the year with the guys.
Yes, a tremendous weekend for DEI. All right, I got.
Dale Earnhardt Incorporated finishes second and third. David Reagan finishes fourth for the second consecutive race at Talladega. He finished fourth here in the spring. Great run for the sixth car. Jeff Burton will come home fifth. His teammate Clint Bowyer in sixth. Bobby Labonte, best run of the year for the King Richard Petty's car number 43. And Bobby Labonte, the former winner here. Scott Riggs, how about Riggs, finishing in eighth place. Robbie Gordon ninth, and Jimmy Johnson coming home in 10th. But it's all about smoke, finally getting it done at Talladega. Jamie.
Oh, and it's a Gatorade bath as he prevails in victory lane. Tony, Greg Zipidelli, your crew chief, told me this morning the way this year has gone, he's been numb. There's been no feelings. What has it been like for you trying to get back to victory lane?
Yeah, I love you too, guys. Man, it's one thing to get back to victory lane, but to do it at Talladega, this is one of about four places I haven't won a cup race at, and man, talk about wanting to win. I've wanted to win here for so long. I got so many friends down here, and Red Farmer and Donnie Allison and all these fans, man. I mean, there's so much orange up there, and I know this hasn't been one of my favorite places on the fan side. You know, people haven't always liked me here, but this was for those guys up in the stands today.
Tony, take us through that last lap, especially the pass at the end. What was going through your mind?
Just don't get too big a gap behind me, and I knew with three DEI cars behind me, it was going to be tough to hold on, but we got a really good push from Regan on the back stretch there, and I thought he was going to be able to stay on the bumper, and if he stayed there, there wasn't anybody going to get to us, but got away from us there and got a gap, and he got a good run. Just had to try to protect at the end.
Congratulations, and 20 starts here at Talladega. Tony Stewart finally goes to victory lane. Alan?
All right, Jamie, well, we know Tony Stewart's won the race. The rest of the results you've been looking at, unofficial till we get the final word on where NASCAR places Regan Smith for that last lap thing. You can check out NASCAR Now, 10 o'clock tonight on ESPN2 if you'd like a little more information. Next weekend, it's on to Charlotte, Nationwide Series Friday night. The Cup race on Saturday night at 7 Eastern. A wild day in Talladega. The championship is shaken up. Jimmy Johnson leads by 68 points. And Tony Stewart is your winner here in Alabama.